spreading the message of peace, freedom, love, and liberty. FPP also gives new authors an avenue for publishing freedom-oriented material. FPP brings you daily news and commentary on the website fpp.cc, as well as a daily 5-minute newscast, FPP Radio News, and weekly news, views, and commentary in the FPP Freedom Minute and Peace, Love, Liberty Radio at fppradio.com, and the monthly newspaper FPP News at news.fpp.cc. Find FPP online at fpp.cc. That's fpp.cc, as in Creative Commons.
So you've heard all 3 hours of the latest episode of Free Talk Live, and you're still hungry for liberty-oriented audio content? Did you know that we have another 24/7 audio stream at lrn.fm? The Liberty Radio Network airs the latest episodes of some of the best liberty-oriented podcasts on the internet, around the clock. In addition to recorded content, you'll also hear live shows like Free Talk Live, originating from our Keene, New Hampshire studio. So listen anytime at lrn.fm. That's lrn.fm.
Liberty activists around the country are starting to realize politics alone won't set us free. So what will? At Liberty on the Rocks, we believe the answer starts with living your principles, spreading ideas, and connecting with those around you. By starting a Liberty on the Rocks network, you can make a difference by uniting libertarian thinkers. Find out how much fun it is to build your local network from the ground up. Visit libertyontherocks.org today to get started.
While our satellite channel is free to listen to, it's not free for us. You can help us cover our satellite costs with the chip-in on the right side of the page at lrn.fm.
Talk Live, 855-450-FREE. It's 855-450-3733. You can call in and talk about whatever is on your mind this evening. It's Mark with you.
And Johnson.
855-450-FREE. I want to tell you about how to get some gold and silver. If you just go to gold.freetalklive.com, they can get gold and silver pieces there, and it's a great deal. From Midas Resources. I've been getting gold and silver from them for a long time. If you think that, if you think like I do, that silver is poised to move upward, I'd recommend using gold.freetalklive.com. Not only are you getting great prices on gold and silver, but you're helping Free Talk Live in the process. It's gold.freetalklive.com. Let's go to Jim calling in from Utah. Jim, you're on Free Talk Live. What's on your mind?
Afternoon, sir. You were talking about the deteriorating relationship between the police and the public.
Yes.
I'm an old man, and I can go way back,
okay.
And I have the distinct, it's a fact. The police started losing credibility and cohesiveness with the general public, at least the men, when they started getting active on the highways.
Okay.
When I was a kid in Michigan, I remember my brother telling me, later on, that there was no speed limit on Michigan highways until sometime in the 50s. So, we all have experience with police on the road, and we're not criminals, but we screw up on the road, and the police stop us. That didn't used to happen, probably until after World War II in earnest, and then our interactions started to cost us money, even though we didn't intend to do any wrong. Previous to that, the police really only dealt with people who had bad intent. And it got worse as the police got radar. I remember that's when I started driving, and the radar cops, that's when police got really lazy because the money got easy.
How did police catch people for speeding before radar?
They timed you. I can't remember what they call it. They paced you. That's what they call it in Michigan.
Okay.
They'd have to stay behind you within, sight and count on you not paying enough attention.
Well,
and
you sure wouldn't be.
You for, I don't know, a month. What's that?
You sure wouldn't be paying attention if a police officer was behind you for however long they had to be behind you.
Right. I mean, and they've got good vision just by natural, because part of their requirements. And they time you or pace you, and then they pull you over for speeding and So in other words, that's how they got in. You get a speeding ticket, but the tickets were cheap, and I don't even know when points finally came in. But it's just been a gradually deteriorating relationship between the police and, well, I'll call it males, generally, who have no bad intent and just get a bad taste from the police. Now, that's gotten, like, once the radar started up, it just got crazy. I mean, they'd drive the side of the road and pull and wave people over. They were just making money hand over foot, and they ruined a lot of people, myself included, you know, just... We didn't have a good feeling about the police, you know, because that's the only time we ever saw them is on the road. And
when I was young, I considered seeing a police car to be a threat when I was young. Now, I'll admit to you, I was not the safest and, you know, best choice for people on the road, right? Like, I'm a lot safer driver than I was when I was a young person, but it sort of doesn't change the perception that I considered the police to be a threat. I will concur with you on that, but... To some extent, people would say, well, roads are safer now, and they are significantly safer. Cars are also safer. And they would also say that...
I don't know how old you gentlemen are, but when in 74, when they come out with that 55-mile-hour speed limit, oh, man, the 55-mile-hour speed limit just changed. I mean, that wrecked everything. That was right about radar detector time, too, now that I think about it. They had us going... I can tell you stories about how they've improved the freeways over the years, and you can do 100 miles an hour in a 1965 car safely on the freeway today, and they've got you putting along at 70, and it takes an act of God to get them to raise the speed limits. So it's just the whole driving experience has been ruined through the money-making machine, you know, and safety, speed kills. No, it doesn't. You know, cross traffic and opposing traffic kills. So they've been lying to us for so long, we're just all kind of worn out from the whole thing there. And I will say that's why my perception of police is less than stellar.
Yep.
Now that I'm an old man, I've slowed down. It isn't as much of an issue, although, you know, I still, you know, don't want to see a cop because I don't know if he's going to pull me over something stupid, taillight, that kind of stuff. But that's what this guy just got killed, got pulled over for.
Yeah, it was for a taillight. There's no doubt about it. Well, Jim.
Yeah. I mean, we have reason to fear these guys. And I'll make another, I know other things. Ever since the 1970s, a retired suburban Detroit policeman, who was a friend of mine, told me this. Ever since the 1970s, the Detroit Police Department has accepted applications from nonviolent felons. And that's all he would say. Now, what that told me was that they had to fill the ranks.
Sounds like it.
Little by little, good people did not want to become cops anymore. So you got to start reaching down lower and having less stellar candidates.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, it seems like police is a, you know, it's a pretty cushy job. You'd think it'd attract a lot of people. I mean, you know, you're talking about work 20 years and you're done.
Ask your friends. Ask your younger friends. I don't know any of them that would want to be a cop. I mean, they tell me that.
Appreciate the call, Jim.
There's no job satisfaction.
Thank you, sir. 855-450-FREE. A lot of times working for the government is a pretty miserable existence. You know, I mean, you find a lot of people who work for the government who are not very happy about it, but they kind of stay for the pension and the money. And it's not, to me, it's not worth working someplace that I wouldn't want to work, even if the pension and the money is good.
You know, one thing he said about the roads that I don't necessarily agree with, you know, in terms of the argument of speed kills, that, you know, there is an argument to be made for the differentials in speed killing.
Yeah, I agree.
Somebody, you know, because he's like, now that I'm old, I slowed down. I almost wanted to say, well, now that you're old and slowing down, you're going to cause an accident with a person who's still going 100 miles an hour.
Right. When you're on the interstate, I find that, you know, there's two people that are sort of dangerous when you're on the interstate. The person who's going 50 and the person who's going 100.
Right.
Right. Like, you know, the rest of us who are going 70, 65 to 85, we can kind of work it all out.
Right.
But
to be honest, I find the person who's going 50 more dangerous than the one who's going 100.
You can believe that there's bottlenecks that are caused people changing lanes. Lane changing's dangerous. Let's go to Mark Stevens calling in from Phoenix. Mark, you're on Free Talk Live. What's in your mind?
Hey, guys. How you doing?
Doing good. Mark Stevens, LRN host. MarkStevens.net. Mark with a C.
Yes. It's good to talk with you again, Mark.
What's on your mind, sir?
Well, on Tuesday, I had the opportunity to confront the Chief Justice of the Arizona Supreme Court. He was doing a lecture there of all things about bias. And I took that as an opportunity. Yeah, I know. he violated all the rules that he had laid out in his talk when it came time for me to speak to him. But I went there on the assumption I would have the opportunity to ask some questions, and so I brought my camera and went down there. And I confronted him on the basic premise that all governments operate under, that I believe should be at the forefront of every court attack or any bureaucratic attack, and that is that if you're physically in New Hampshire or Arizona, then the laws of the government of that area apply to you. And so I was able to confront him on that, and he went immediately to mocking me and not giving me any actual evidence to support his argument, of course.
So you were talking to him about jurisdiction. I'm interested. You got a chance to talk to the Supreme Court Justice. This should be quite interesting. Please hold the line if you would, Mark. 855-450-3733 or lrn.fm on Skype.
So we decided to upgrade the look of our home.
You know, improve the curb appeal.
We decided to add the look of stone to the exterior.
We really like the stacked stone look.
Yeah, but when I checked into the price, it was ridiculous. No way could we afford it.
Then a friend told me about Genstone. G-E-N-S-T-O-N-E.
Genstone comes in lightweight panels made of polyurethane. They've actually engineered the hassle out of installation. No mortar, no mesh. It was easy. Even I could do it.
We just screwed the panels to the wall and it looks like stone. I mean, it really looks like stone.
Yeah, from the box to the wall in minutes.
We love the look of our home now.
And Genstone is durable, comes with a 25-year warranty, and offers additional R-value for insulation.
If you want the look of stone at a price you can afford, call Genstone.
At 855-955-STONE.
Trust me, you'll save money.
And you'll love the look.
855-955-STONE. That's 855-955-7866.
On Free Talk Live, we're bringing people to the ideas of liberty every day. From wrestling superstars like Glenn Jacobs.
You guys really are having an impact, I believe. Like I said, a lot of where I am now is due to listening to Free Talk Live. You changed my mind on some very important issues years ago.
To random people tuning in on the radio.
I was kind of stuck in the left-right paradigm. I heard your show by chance on a Saturday night. From there, I went on doing the Free State Project and become an amplifier. So, I mean, that's really the reason why I amp is because I know that if it wasn't for you guys being on as many stations as you are, I never would have found the ideas of liberty.
Your amp will directly change more lives by getting Free Talk Live in front of people looking for talk radio online and on the air. You can help by joining the AMP program for just $5 a month at amp.freetalklive.com and getting perks. That's amp.freetalklive.com.
New Hampshire is under quarantine as walking corpses devour the flesh of the living. Max is 11 years old and surviving alone. Slow-moving and non-thinking, the dead swarm his home. Now he must apply his Porcupine Freedom Scouts training to improvise his escape. Look for Survivor Max on Facebook, read reviews on Amazon, or read Chapter 1 at SurvivorMax.com.
DVD, books, music, instruments, periodicals, computers, software, electronics, photo, cell phone, office products, home and garden, bed and bath, furniture, kitchen, pet supplies, automotive, hardware, apparel, shoes, jewelry, grocery, healthcare, sports and outdoors, toys, games, used and more.
It's a department store at your fingertips. Shop.freetalklive.com. Get all your shopping done, get a great deal, and a portion of your purchase goes to benefit Free Talk Live when you enter Amazon via shop.freetalklive.com. Are you looking for an excuse to come check out New Hampshire this fall? You're invited to Keenvention. Keenvention is your chance to meet dozens of key liberty activists from across the Shire. You can explore the beautiful little city of Keene, discuss various forms of activism with seasoned veterans, do some Robin Hooding, and learn about making the move. Keenvention received rave reviews last year. If you missed it, visit keenvention.info for full video coverage of every speaker and panel. This year's keynote speeches and panels will be announced via the Keenvention blog and Facebook, so stay tuned there for the latest. Join old and new friends and neighbors in Keene for Keenvention this October 30th through November 1st. Tickets are available now at a special early bird price of just $50 via credit card or Bitcoin. That $50 price only lasts through the end of June, so don't delay. Reserve your tickets now at keenvention.info. Visit keenvention.info for more and look for our page and event on Facebook. That's keenvention.info.
Do you love Twitter? Make sure you favorite the LRN.FM Twitter account so you can receive our tweets at twitter.lrn.fm. That's twitter.lrn.fm.
Free Talk Live, 855-450-FREE. It's 855-450-3733. You can call in and talk about whatever's on your mind here on Free Talk Live. It's Mark with you.
And Johnson.
Ian is away this evening and may return by the end of the show, but we don't know for sure. So you can call in and talk about what you want, though. 855-450-FREE. You're online. If you're online, you need to protect yourself. Your internet service provider is saving your surfing history. We'll turn it over to anybody who asks, or at least any government agency that asks. Criminals are sniffing out your Wi-Fi packets, and governments and corporations are limiting what you can see on the internet and tracking everything that they can find out you're doing.
I like that verbal flub, though. Just anybody who asks, just I want to walk in. What's Mark's surfing history? Let's find out.
Yeah, you'd be bored. Simply download an app for Windows, Mac, iOS, or Android, even Linux, and then just connect to the internet, and you're protected from all of that. No prying, no spying. Now, I say that you'd be bored with my surfing history, but the fact is when...
I'm sure I would be bored. You don't want to see mine.
When agencies, policing agencies, find out what you're doing, there have been people who, really ordinary folks doing ordinary things who, for whatever reason, some policing agencies like targets them and decides that they're bad folks for what they've been looking at on the internet.
Sure.
And that's a reason why you would want to protect yourself online. And ProXPN can help you do it. And you can save a lot of money. Just go to proxpn.com/FTL and use promo code FTL50 to save 50% off of the annual account. And that is for the lifetime of the account, not just one time. 50% off if you go to proxpn.com/FTL50.
So that heinous crone Dianne Feinstein wants to ban the anarchist cookbook from the internet now.
Yeah.
So, you know, that's the type of thing that if they find it in your search history, or if you're looking at libertarian websites, you might be a domestic terrorist.
I'm going to have to go check out the Anarchist Cookbook online. Let's go back to Mark Stevens. So, Mark Stevens, you had an opportunity at apparently some kind of lecture or seminar to get a chance to talk to the Chief Justice of the Arizona Supreme Court. And apparently, he didn't take your questions very seriously.
You better be careful, Mark, or they're going to throw you in one of those Joe Arpaio ovens that he has for the prisoners out there.
Well, I'm kind of used to the heat out here. That's always a chance that you take when you're going into the lion's den. This was at ASU, and I did ask the question. And basically, all governments operate under the same presumption or argument. If you're physically in Canada, then the laws of Canada apply. If you're physically in Arizona, then the laws apply. And the judge, of course, agrees to that. And I have many call chains from all over the world where they agree to that. The problem that they have is that there's not a single shred of evidence, not a single fact to actually support that argument. And up until Tuesday, the highest level of government I've been able to get a question that, you know, and confront on was John Buttrick last year, who is a federal magistrate here in Phoenix. So this is the highest judicial officer in Arizona, and he's a Harvard law grad. So when I asked him for the facts, if any, to support his argument, he went immediately to a logical fallacy that, well, we'll put you in prison. And if it's okay, Mark, I mean, it's only about a minute long.
No, I want to hear it.
Play that.
Oh, you can play it?
Okay.
Let's try it.
Yeah, I can play it. Okay.
My name is Mark Stevens. I host a radio show here in the Valley called the No State Project. A couple of questions going to the nature of the government that you are a part of. And I know that all governments, and I've had this confirmed by the Attorney General and other judges and prosecutors, that the argument is that if I am physically in Arizona, then the Constitution and laws of the government of Arizona apply to me, and you as the government would have jurisdiction over me. My question for you is, do you have any actual facts that would actually prove that argument's true? That's funny.
I'm not sure I understand the question, and I'm not sure that your proposition of what the legal principle is is correct, because I'm not sure I heard you correctly. If you're asking, is it in fact true that if you're physically in Arizona, you're subject to the laws of this state, I think that's right.
Yes, and my question to you is that that's your argument, and that's what prosecutors and police officers are throwing peaceful people in prison for every day. Cops go out on the street, they see you, they feel, oh, he's physically here, our laws apply. We're going to go and investigate. My question for you is, do you have any actual proof, any empirical evidence, facts, to support that argument?
Yes, because people who are physically here and violate our laws are, in fact, prosecuted and incarcerated.
Well, that's what Bill Montgomery said. That's called an argument. Well, let me finish. That's called an argumentum ad baculum. That's not support for your argument. Just because you're physically willing...
You asked me if I had facts to support the argument, so an argument ad factum is quite appropriate.
Well, he didn't answer the question.
It's more difficult to hear there, but that's when they ran interference with me, as
right.
You can imagine.
You're done.
You're done.
You're out of here. So, yeah, let's run this question down, because I know that a lot of people, you know, like you people, when I read your book, Adventures in Legal Land, I found it to be very convincing and an interesting sort of topic. Like, what makes it so the government has power in a given geographic area? But I would say that the you know, basically, they're the Lord. They've taken over the power that at one point sat with the sovereign in any given area. You know, the count sat over a county, and the duke sat over a duchy, and I guess which was a bunch of counties stuck together. I'm not entirely sure how all this works, and that person was the sovereign. So the government has just stepped in with they've taken over that the power of the sovereign, who basically owned all the land, and then the rest of us lived on it. I mean, isn't that really what the answer is? Is that the government owns the land and essentially controls everybody who's in it like a serf?
Well, the way they operate is much like is a criminal organization. They force everybody in a certain geographic area to pay them and do what they're told, or they will kill them or put them in prison. It's comply or die. And the problem for someone like the Supreme Court justice is they don't want to come right out and say that they're a gang of killers, thieves, and liars, because that's bad PR. So they put on the facade that they're there acting on behalf of the people who they force to pay, and that they're just representatives, and that they are the moral authority in that area.
Right.
And in by going to a logical fallacy and then taking a shot at me, now I was being – the dean was running interference with me, so I didn't really hear all that he had to say in the moment. But he admitted it was an argumentum ad baculum, which is really just an appeal to consequences.
Didn't he say argumentum ad faculum? Didn't he say something somewhere different?
He changed. He said his contradictory. It was a fact. So I offered facts as evidence. Therefore,
it's appropriate.
Oh, I thought he just repeated that it was ad baculum.
No, go listen. No. Go ahead and listen and see what he says. I don't even know what baculum means. I'm not, I'm not up on my Latin here. So,
well, I'll join on the Latin crew, and Mark, and I'll say that what you presented as the argument for government is actually the logical fallacy of argumentum ad antiquitatem, which is the argument from tradition, which is just saying like, oh, because we've always done it this way, that's why we keep doing it that way.
Well, it's not exactly. I mean, what is ownership, right? I mean, that's the question you'd have to ask yourself, is if the government claims to own, say, a given geographic area, and it's like it's some kind of super ownership that comes above ownership. So you can get the title to a piece of land, but you don't have the ability to not pay an annual rent on that land that they call a property tax.
Right, because we've always done it that way.
And so that's a logical fallacy.
It is, though.
Well, it's not.
You're making the argument from tradition that's the reason why that's acceptable to do that, because it's always been done that way.
That's like saying my property belongs to me just because I lived on it yesterday. That's not true. I'm not claiming that the government does in fact own the land, but at the very least they should come out and say it, right? Like, we own the land, and when you're on the land, we own you too. We own we own the labor, and we own the land because those are the means of production, and those are the valuable things in the world, so we've claim them for ourselves. As long as they were to do that, then I think we've had a huge step forward. Mark?
I don't know that I'm...
Well, yeah, and I think Mark wasn't making a case for government. Mark was just putting out what the argument is.
Right, no. Oh, yeah, no, I was just saying that I think that argument for government is a logical fallacy, and I think there's a lot of people basing their whole reality off of logical fallacies every day.
Mark, I want to hear what... I've got another couple of questions for you. Can you hold on?
Sure, I'd be happy to.
Thanks. 855-450-3733. What do you think the factual argument for the existence of the state is? Because I want to hear it. Please tell me. 855-450-3733. What gives its legitimacy? 855-450-FREE.
How strong is Allegra D?
It's my congestion's out of my way strong. Even in the park, playing with my dogs. Go fetch, Bosley.
Allegra D, a fast, non-drowsy antihistamine plus a powerful decongestant that starts relieving your toughest allergy symptoms in under 1 hour.
Allegra D is breathing free for 24 hours strong, even in the convertible.
Allegra D, strong relief for your allergy symptoms. Guaranteed or your money back. Visit Allegra.com. Use only as directed.
Here's a good idea. When you have a legal matter like creating your will or legally setting up a business with a corporation or LLC, you don't necessarily need a law firm. Use LegalZoom.com. At LegalZoom.com, you answer straightforward questions online and they take care of the rest. They even review your answers for common mistakes and guarantee your satisfaction. Free Talk Live listeners, you'll get 10% off your order by typing in FTL in the referral box at purchase. Don't procrastinate with these important legal documents. LegalZoom.com.
If the IRS has garnished your paycheck or seized money from your bank account, you need to get professional tax help now. Fast action is required to put a halt to these aggressive IRS collection tactics. You can count on the knowledgeable team of tax professionals at Wall & Associates. With over 30 years of experience, Wall & Associates has settled the tax problems of thousands of taxpayers for a small fraction of what they owed. For a free face-to-face consultation, call 1-800-425-4610 to put a wall between you and the IRS. 1-800-425-4610 or look for us on the web at wallandassociates.net. We solve tax problems. If you hire Wall & Associates today, you'll never have to talk to the IRS again. To stop the levies and seizures today, take action now. Call Wall & Associates at 1-800-425-4610. Wall & Associates. 1-800-425-4610.
Based on actual cases, results may vary. Not a solicitation for legal services.
Free Talk Live's recent Bitcoin sale was a big success, so we decided to extend the 50% discount through April 17th.
Free Talk Live was the first ad venue in the world to accept Bitcoins for ads. We love the concept of a value-based digital currency that allows people to actually control their own money.
We introduced Roger Ver,
Bitcoin Jesus,
to Bitcoins, and here's what he said.
Free Talk Live is the premier voice for the peace and liberty Bitcoin will bring to the world. By broadcasting this message since 2011, Free Talk Live has been instrumental in creating the widespread adoption that we have today.
If you need some advertising for your business, website, or organization, and you want to save half off, send me an email right now, mark@freetalklive.com.
This is your chance to save 50% on national radio and podcast ads. Just pay with Bitcoin. Email mark@freetalklive.com. That's mark@freetalklive.com.
The three most important things you can do for Free Talk Live are, one, share one episode a week on Facebook or in some other social networking site. Two, buy the things you buy online through shop.freetalklive.com. Three, give $5 a month to the AMP program. It's my firm belief that Free Talk Live's AMP program is the best use of your charitable dollar among liberty-oriented organizations. Support all the organizations you love. But make sure you give $5 a month to AMP at amp.freetalklive.com. I love my magic mud. I drink a lot of coffee. I had stains on my teeth. Then I found my magic mud, and I was told it would remove stains. So I paid attention when I brushed the first time. My magic mud is black tooth powder, and the difference it made in my teeth in one application was noticeable. With four, my teeth were as white as you normal folks out there. Please go to mymagicmud.com and buy a jar. There's 150 applications for $25. You can use Bitcoin. Mymagicmud.com.
Listen to LRN.FM on any phone, anytime. 213-493-0309. That's 213-493-0309.
Talk Live, 855-450-3733. It's 855-450-FREE. Do your online shopping at shop.freetalklive.com. There we have some major retailers, Amazon included. Newegg comes to mind. I think Walmart's there. When you do your online shopping through that link, it's just an extra click, but we get a little bonus. You get the same prices, the same service you normally get, but we get a little spiff off of it. They send it to us. So that is a great way for us to make a few bucks, and you don't have to do much else. It's shop.freetalklive.com, and it makes a great deal of difference. Let's go back to Mark Stevens from markstevens.net. He had recently confronted the Arizona Supreme Court justice and basically been laughed out of the room. But I mean, I think some of his questions are sort of really relevant. Is what gives this organization calling itself the government, what gives it its validity? Mark, isn't it just we do? Like all of us, all the people think, enough people think the same thing, that this organization needs to be present, so therefore those people can essentially enforce their will on the others. Might makes right. Mark?
Still have Mark?
Well, I have him on the air. There he is. Go ahead.
Hello?
Yep, go right ahead.
And I think that's like that's an analogy. We like if enough people bought beer from Al Capone and not Bugs Moran, that would make Al Capone a legitimate organization. They can't be legitimate as long as they are just people forcing us to pay them, which is why they can never prove that their laws apply to anybody, which is why the Supreme Court justice here in Arizona can't prove the laws apply any more than any other bureaucrat. It's the force. They can't be legitimate. People tolerate them.
Right.
It's like I had a professor tell me the other day, but I'm happy to pay so we get all these nice buildings and whatnot, you know, of course, his pension. I said, yeah, but that doesn't really hold any merit to it, because as long as you are being forced to pay, I can't really believe that you're happy to pay it. Unless you're
even if he does like doing it, it doesn't mean that he can enforce his will on someone else. I mean, I may really love my auto insurance company, but if they were the only choice I had and I had to pay them, their service would probably diminish relatively quickly. That's one of the features of a monopoly, is bad customer service and high prices, right?
Well, sure, but the idea that it smacks of the Stockholm syndrome to say that I enjoy getting, you know, being extorted.
Yep.
I enjoy it because I get benefits from. Well, that it's never held any merit to me that I always look at, you know, look, the facts that we can observe and we can prove, as opposed to someone telling us how they subjectively feel about something, should always rule out. The objective facts are you pay or you go to jail or you die, and from there, it doesn't matter if somebody claims, I'm so happy to pay. No. Until the force is removed, you have no credibility to say that you enjoy doing that. I don't buy it, and I don't think a rational person looking at the evidence should either.
Well, what about this?
Should always take precedence.
I don't disagree with you, but you know, I'm just taking devil's advocate role here. So I don't make a ton of money. I'm not one of the I'm not in the wealthiest 2% or whatever. And the people that are in those demographics, the top 10% of earners, tends to pay most, the vast majority of the taxes. So essentially what I'm getting is a society that's paid for by somebody else. I pay a small amount in order to sort of play, but mostly these other people do. Now, we know the government's an entirely inefficient organization, and that they the things that they buy cost you know, between 2 and 7 times, from what, 1.5 and 7 times, depending on the size of the government and all kinds of other factors, seems to be the numbers. So, but I mean, even if that's the case, it's not my money that's being wasted. I'm paying a small amount for what I'm getting. Couldn't I like it for that
really
reason?
That's not really relevant to whether they're a legitimate organization.
No, it's not relevant to that, but it's relevant to whether or not I like the deal, right? I like the deal where somebody else pays $9 out of $10 for something that I get.
But do you like being extorted? Do you like being told that you either do this or you go to jail or we kill you in the process?
Well, I get that that's the extortion, but as long as that's leveled at somebody else also that has to pay 9 out of 10, you know, of the dollars, then at that point my extortion looks pretty good.
Well, yeah, your slavery is a little bit less than the slavery on them. However, it's another discussion to get into how the super wealthy, of course, keep us poor by all the government regulations and interference.
There's a lot of that.
I wanted people to be able to hear this and realize that when we do go and are attacked by these people, and someone did this just recently, just this week, it's posted on my forum, that they beat the snot out of an attorney, a prosecutor, by doing just this and sticking just to that argument and objecting because they wouldn't have the facts. Now, if a Supreme Court justice and a Harvard Law School graduate cannot present a single fact to support that argument, it's not a matter because Mark Stevens is a crank as some liberty activists have claimed. It's not because my question was irrelevant and stupid. It's because there are no facts to prove the laws apply. That's the basis of their jurisdiction. It's the basis of every attack that they make, and that should be the one that we should be hammering away at when they're attacking us. And even when we're as working as activists, when we go and speak to them, that should be the foremost challenge, I think.
I feel like, Mark, just to clarify for some people, what would be like an example of a legal fact? You know, like a fact that would clarify something like this. I mean, obviously, in this particular case, there are no facts. But, like, let's say you were making that argument about something similar. And because it sounds like, you know, when you're asking for a fact, it's just, I know in legalese, a fact is something different than, you know, I don't know, let's say the gravity is -9.8 meters per second squared. Like, that's a fact, you know. But what is it when it's like a legalese fact?
A legalese fact is not any different than a regular fact. When you get into legalese, you're talking about the difference between a fact and evidence, an actual proof, something
sure.
that's called, you know. So a fact is something that's real, something that's happened, it's something that's empirical, it's something that's observable, or you can hear it, you can measure it. An opinion is something that's drawn from those facts, and they're not, it's not the same thing. An opinion is not real, it's just what you think of the fact. And here all I'm doing is calling a bluff, and it's a general response from a bureaucrat to say, well, what evidence are you looking for? So, whoa, you made the determination. You're willing to kill me that you think it's so true. What did you base it on? And it also goes that I'm not the one making the argument that, and this is for people who are being attacked also. We're not having the burden of proof. Logic tells us that the one making the accusation bears the burden of proof. So people have asked, well, what facts would you look for? Well, if someone's saying that their rules apply to me, I'd have to look at some kind of agreement, which, of course, you don't have with people called government, because it's either comply or die. And so my point and my goal in getting this information out there so people can see that is don't be so intimidated by these lawyers, even these so-called liberty activists, who will poo-poo the idea of challenging jurisdiction. If the Supreme Court – now people can hear and see for themselves, the Supreme Court justice of in Arizona, the chief, unable to provide a single fact.
Where can I see
the
that?
Argument. Well, I'm going to actually get the video posted on markstevens.net tomorrow. And so I have my own video, and there's the video from ASU.
Let me ask you this.
ASU.
Is a town charter – essentially a legal fact that, you know, everybody in the town of Freedomville got together and decided that they would put together a government and that government would operate in this way or that way, and that that gives that organization legitimacy to operate within that given geographic area because everybody agreed?
Well, if everybody agreed and you had facts to show that there was no guns and they freely agreed that and they owned the property in question, so let's say it's a very small area and you had, let's say, 25 people and all 25 people and there was no – they could agree or not agree and no force would be used against them, they wouldn't be expelled, then that would be something that may have some legitimacy. But what we have now, no, not for – and I would just like to see more people striking at the root. Not getting into arguments of what government should or should not do. Or I would like to see more people confronting them and making the moral issue that they are just a gang of killers, thieves, and liars, which is why I ask a follow-up question, which I have other follow-up questions I asked the judge after this, you know, when we went to the reception. And so the main question was that he just laughed and walked away. If I was to do things like your organization, the government, and I forced people to give me money, would you consider me a criminal? And in that, you know, in a sense, force is the moral issue. And so whether they answer the question or not is completely irrelevant because the people, the audience, they understand what's going on and they'll understand why the bureaucrat won't answer. So I just would like to see more people make a moral argument and attacking the foundation of their so-called legitimacy.
I think you'll find a few people in the audience that get it, right? Like the thinkers. But I think a lot of people just don't spend a lot of time asking questions. It's like, there's another person that's just asking stupid questions. I hate them. You know, like I don't know. I guess I just don't trust the common individual. Mark, thanks for the call. I appreciate it. 855-450-FREE. It's 855-450-3733. Am I wrong? Should I trust the wisdom of crowds?
Indefinite extension of the human lifespan is coming. But is it coming soon enough for you and me?
That's the $80,000 question. I say $80,000 because that's what it costs to have your head cryonically frozen by Alcor. I've committed to do it. I got a life insurance policy, and I made them the beneficiaries. Bam, my best shot at living forever. Interested? Contact them at alcor.org. ALCOR.ORG. Mention my name, and I get a free year of membership.
The results are in. For the treatment of nasal allergy symptoms, nothing is more effective than Nasacort. Nasacort Allergy 24-Hour is prescription-strength medicine that's sentin alcohol-free with no harsh taste. It's non-addictive and provides 24-hour relief of the worst nasal allergy symptoms, including congestion, with no prescription needed. And in a recent clinical study with Nasacort going nose-to-nose with Flonase, more people prefer Nasacort. For more information, visit Nasacort.com. Nasacort. Use as directed.
Ross Ulbricht was convicted in early 2015 of running the infamous Silk Road Underground Market. The Silk Road was a gift to humanity and helped reduce the harms brought on by drug prohibition. For this good deed, Ross may be spending the rest of his life in prison. His family is planning to appeal his conviction, but they need your support. Please visit FreeRoss.org, where you can contribute via various methods, including Bitcoin. Ross needs your help now more than ever. Visit FreeRoss.org. That's FreeRoss.org. You can listen to Free Talk Live on the radio, podcast, satellite, webcam, and our live streams. But did you know you can listen to Free Talk Live from any phone, anywhere? Add this number to your phone, 213-493-0308. It's a long-distance call, so make sure you're familiar with your phone's calling plan. The listen lines are airing the latest episode of Free Talk Live 24 hours a day, including our live shows. Call 213-493-0308. That's 213-493-0308.
You're listening to the live edition of Free Talk Live. Hour number two is next, after the news, here on the Liberty Radio Network at LRN.FM.
From Keene in the Shire, the Liberty Media capital of the world, this is Daryl W. Perry, host of FPP Radio News for Thursday, April 9th, 2015. Silver is trading at $16.33 per ounce. Gold is valued at $1,200 per ounce. And according to BitcoinAverage.com, the average price of Bitcoin is $244. Antiwar.com reports, despite years of haranguing from the U.S. and threats to sanction Pakistan, the Iran-Pakistan natural gas pipeline will finally be built by Chinese company CNPC, according to reports. Initially floated as an Iran-Pakistan-India pipeline, the project has been pushed as a way for Pakistan to solve decades of crippling energy shortages that have led to intermittent blackouts in major cities. India withdrew from the project in 2009, saying the prices negotiated were no longer attractive. Pakistan still wanted and needed the gas, but the U.S. State Department has repeatedly threatened to impose crippling economic sanctions on them for daring to do business with Iran. The insertion of a Chinese company into the situation changes it dramatically and seems to be the result of the latest framework deal with Iran and a planned easing of sanctions. As a permanent U.N. Security Council member, China is in a much better position to thumb their nose at idle U.S. threats over the pipeline. And given recent diplomatic progress, it will be difficult for the U.S. to even try to retaliate over the matter. For over 35 years, Roberts & Roberts has been a trusted source for buying and selling your investment-grade precious metals. They also take Bitcoin for precious metal purchases and permanently removed the minimum purchase order for all orders paid in the digital currency. Call Roberts & Roberts today for knowledgeable advice on investing and a forward-thinking approach to new technologies. 850-478-5270 or online at rrbi.co. UPI reports a Texas federal judge refused to lift a temporary block on a White House immigration plan that would defer deportation for up to 5 million people in the country illegally. U.S. District Judge Andrew Hanen rejected a request by the federal government that he stay his February 16th decision, which granted a preliminary injunction blocking President Obama's executive action. He said the government has not shown any credible reason why the order needed to be set into action immediately. Texas
Texas and 25 other states, largely Republican, sued to stop Obama's action, saying it was a constitutional overreach of power and would force them to spend more on law enforcement, healthcare, and education. Hanen wrote in the order, "There is no pressing emergent need for this program. If there had been such a need, the Department of Homeland Security could have implemented the program at any time in the last 5 or even 10 years. In November, Obama signed the order that also granted benefits to some parents of legal residents and citizens. The move has become a flashpoint across the nation. The U.S. Department of Justice also appealed the matter to the 5th U.S. Circuit Court of Appeals. Oral arguments are set to begin April 17th. On Tuesday, Hanen also said the administration misled him when it revealed last month the federal government had issued expanded worker permits to some 100,000 workers in the country illegally before the court blocked the program from beginning. He told the government to supply more information on the issue by April 21st. When her plush and comfy life suddenly and unexpectedly fell apart, Brooke and her dog Cloud set out to defy the odds. If this is a man's world, as they say, living on the streets is no place for a young woman. One day she awoke in the redwood forest and realized she had become a hobo, and would ultimately come to know exactly what it means to survive. How to Be a Hobo by Brooke Willett is available from Amazon.com and all major bookstores. Reuters reports Boston Marathon bomber Zokhar Tsarnaev's conviction on Wednesday came as a relief to residents of the city of Boston, though many expressed mixed feelings over whether the 21-year-old should be put to death for his crimes. Tsarnaev was found guilty in federal court of killing 3 people and injuring 264 others by detonating twin bombs at the finish line of the world-famous race in 2013. The jury will now decide whether Tsarnaev should be executed. After the verdict was read, bombing survivors Karen Broussard said at a news conference that she and other survivors were grateful for the guilty verdict, but she said the survivors also had differing views on whether Tsarnaev deserves the death penalty. Massachusetts scrapped the death penalty in 1984, but capital punishment is still available in cases that are under federal jurisdiction. This has been FPP Radio News, online at fppradio.com.
Months after identifying the elusive Higgs boson particle, scientists at CERN in Geneva, Switzerland have announced that they've completely run out of things to do with their Large Hadron Collider.
We've tried some time travel stuff, but it doesn't really work. Black holes, but we already know like a ton about those. Last week, we threw a bird in there. Honestly, we thought it would take way longer to find the Higgs boson.
Director General of CERN, Ralph Dieter Hauer, told reporters that while they, quote, might be able to figure out some more about quarks or something, for the most part, his team has spent much of the past year throwing pennies into the machine and turning it on to see if the pennies come out smushed.
We might just start building a larger hadron collider. Yeah, maybe a bigger collider for smaller hadrons or something. I don't know.
CERN has announced on their website that if anyone out there has any fun ideas for experiments, you can email them to ideas@largehadroncollider.com.
This is the Onion News Network.
Free Talk Live, 855-450-FREE. It's 855-450-3733. You can call in and talk about whatever's on your mind here. It's Mark.
And Johnson.
For those of you wondering where Ian is, I know we're starting a new hour, new station's coming on. Ian is off tonight at the city council meeting trying to save the people of Keene from getting increased parking fines up from $5. So there you go. The White Knight rides again.
So I just want to quickly mention, Mark, on the break, we've been talking about, like, you know, low-carb diet stuff. And last Thursday I had brought up something about people like who are glucose intolerant, and there was a study that said that glucose, yeah, gluten intolerant, and see, I'm thinking of that low carb stuff, but anyway, I brought up something that said that gluten intolerance was maybe not a real thing. There was a study that was done, and I had a listener who sent me a more current study that suggests that gluten intolerance potentially is a real thing. But looking at both of these studies, it seemed a little inconclusive, and I still the original study basically suggested that people who are gluten intolerant, a good portion of them, for sure, absolutely, who went on a low FODMAP diet, right?
That's a FODMAP?
The FODMAP is that particular short chain carbohydrates, essentially, is the way to boil it down. Let's just boil it down.
Sugars?
The easy way. Most sugars. Yeah, a lot of sugars, certain starchy carbs, simple carbs. That those people who went on low FODMAP diets rather than low carb diets were able to, or sorry, with, rather than no gluten diets, that they were able to eat gluten and have it not affect them in a way that was like celiac, or, you know, not affect them completely badly.
Okay.
So they were, if they were on a low FODMAP diet, that it sort of shielded them from their gluten intolerance.
Is this your version of a retraction?
Sort of. I mean, what I'm saying is I guess the information seems to me to be inconclusive. There are two studies, and the first one had more information in it. This was a sort of a study from late 2013, and then there's now a study that was released in early 2015 that says that gluten intolerance may be real. But essentially, the first study said that, and I don't think that the second study controlled for this, which was that people on low FODMAP diets did not experience gluten sensitivity.
There you go.
So that's essentially what it was. So, yeah, sorry, it's a little complicated, a little weird, but, you know, my thought is, hey, if you think you're gluten intolerant, try going a low FODMAP diet. Maybe it'll...
And look up FODMAP first.
Yeah, right? Yeah. Well, I don't think they're going to be able to do that if they don't know what... But, so maybe try that and see if, it, you know, your gluten intolerance goes away. Just to be more specific, I mean, there are so many different things that are FODMAPs that, you know, you could really specify. Maybe it's onions, you know, like maybe it's some one of those things that are a particular short chain carbohydrate that's bugging people. And it's, you know, I think too many people are just going, it's gluten, and, you know, knocking all the gluten out of their diet. And maybe that's not what they need to do. You know, maybe that's not specific enough, and you could be more specific, and then that would be a much better way to live, I would think. You know, you're not cutting out as much out of your diet.
There's so many choices with gluten-free diets at this point that it hardly makes much difference. I mean, you know.
I don't know about
go
that.
Go ahead.
Sure.
Might as well. You
sure.
Want to go gluten-free? Have fun.
If your diet strategy is carpet bombing. That's how I feel like cutting out everything of a particular type, but.
This article that we were reading in the last hour, I think, has a lot more in it. Basically, it's from The Guardian, and what it's talking about is how the disparity between white and black Americans regarding their trust of the police and the overall diminishment in trust of the police since the early 80s. So the chart here basically looks at whites and blacks with their comfort and trust in the police. And in 1981... the answer was 81% of whites and 72% of blacks sort of had a positive confidence in the police. It's called a confidence gap. Whereas today, basically in, I think it was June 2014, that has diminished from whites from 81 to now 58, big drop. It's more than 20 points. And that's 20% of whites just, you know, no longer trust the police. And blacks from 72% down to 31%. That's twice
wow.
The drop.
Right.
And
it's still a majority of whites by a small margin that have trust in the police, 58%. But
yep.
32%, I mean, that's like less than people who still like Bush at the end of his term.
So there's a couple of issues in this chart that police departments need to look at. And they need to stop looking out and saying, oh, those people hate us. We're a persecuted class. I mean, you can almost hear this in the voices of some police officers that have called into the show. Others have completely understood that, look, you're not a persecuted class if you're the ones with the guns that get to do whatever you want.
Right.
At some point or another, you need to start looking internally. And this is my recommendation to police departments around America.
I want to bring up a compare and contrast because this is kind of interesting. I'm just running through, my brain is running through statistics here. And I'm thinking like to myself, wait a minute. Among blacks, you're saying that the approval rating for police is 32%, which is
31, yeah.
31%. So that's What's crazy to me is that isn't Congress's current approval rating 11%?
It hovers even lower than that sometimes.
That's amazing to me.
Congress comes in like just below cholera and roaches.
What's absolutely amazing and outstanding about that is this. I would think that the police approval rating would be lower than that. It's just kind of interesting that it's even that high.
A 20 to 30 point confidence gap has separated black opinion and white opinion about policing since the early 90s, according to the Gallup data. The data was last published in 2014 before some of the most high profile police killings. This is all this stuff is before Garner, before Ferguson, before Tamir Rice, right, a 12-year-old, and before this most recent one in South Carolina, North Charleston. The gap in confidence in police between black and white poll respondents was measured at only 9 points in 1981, but by 1993, 2 years after the King beating that sparked the Los Angeles riots, it had grown to 24%. In 95, 91% of white respondents in polling conducted by Gallup said they had a great deal or quite a lot of confidence in the police. The number for black respondents was 65%. So that's nearly 30% gap. A gap in options about police opinions, ran along income lines, too, with a 13-point spread between the top 20% of earners and the bottom 20%. So what a surprise if you're, in the lower classes, somehow or another you believe that police are – you have less confidence in
police.
It's
also – okay, so this is also an interesting fact to me, that the economic spread is only 13 points and that the racial spread was wider. That seems to me to be a very strong indicator that – the reality of racism among the police is extremely true, because if it were really just, poor people, I would think that if the police weren't actively being racist, that the spread amongst the economic divide would be wider than the spread amongst the racial divide.
Yeah, I would like to believe that police aren't, making choices based on race and that sort of thing, but I did a thought experiment with myself, and I've got to say that I didn't do well from my own point of view. And here's what I asked myself. If somebody in government decides the way to solve this problem with the disparity in race is to hire nothing but black cops from here on out, for the next 5 years, we're going to hire nothing but black police officers. And then I attempted to live in that world, and then I tested my emotions compared to that. And, I could see that makes me uncomfortable. And it's not because, it's not because of who the, obviously I put the criteria together. So it's not about there'd be some white people that should be cops that don't get hired. That's not what I'm talking about, me feeling uncomfortable. What I'm thinking is that somehow this is going to, it's going to be not so great for me as somebody who's going to be perceived of as white by these black cops. And I would ask you, how do you feel, if you're white, about the idea of, let's just hire black cops from here on out? If you don't think there's a racial problem, then there shouldn't be a racial problem if we hire black cops. What does that make you think? I mean, maybe I'm all
wrong. I've got a take on this.
855-450-3733. It's 855-450-FREE. Free Talk Live.
I'm Steve Sitkowski, a former Wall Street insider. I'm holding a book that will show you investing strategies which could help you earn the kind of money you've always dreamed about. And right now, I'm giving this book away for free. So who needs to read it? If you're in the middle of your career and worry you'll never have enough money to retire, you need to read this book. If you're already retired and your income isn't enough, you need to read this book. And if you don't want to be selling burgers at 80, you need to read this free book. It includes the strategy I use to make a 72% profit on a trade where the stock only moved 12%. You'll need at least $1 million to ever fully retire. If you're behind on that goal, you really need to read Trade Like the Pros. And you can for free by calling 1-800-944-5836. Skeptical that it will deliver results? It's a free book, so what do you have to lose? Find out how at 1-800-944-5836. 1-800-944-5836.
This is Mark of Free Talk Live. We've been witnessing a meltdown of the economic engine that powers our country. With a printing press tethered to Washington bureaucrats and New York central bankers, how can we trust paper money? For years, I've been buying gold and silver from Midas Resources, and you should too. Call 877-357-9938 for a free book titled 10 Reasons to Own Gold, or go to gold.freetalklive.com. Again, 877-357-9938.
877-357-9938.
Farmers keep livestock lean and healthy with a mineral-rich diet. Then, before market, they cut off minerals, leaving them to crave high-calorie grains. If weight control is this easy, why prescribe surgery for humans? Introducing Youngevity. You could avoid 900 diseases by getting 90 essential nutrients from Youngevity. Check out 90 for Life at tobeyoungagain.com or call 855-79-YOUNG. That's 855-79-YOUNG or tobeyoungagain.com. Youngevity. It's all about saving money, getting healthy, and creating wealth.
This is the Onion Week in Review. According to sources, all 6.5 million residents of Indiana spontaneously formed thousands of perfectly uniform rows throughout the state Monday morning and established a collective consciousness. Saying, "We are Indiana," the new hive mind talked and moved in unison, with citizens working together to build a massive geometric superstructure in downtown Indianapolis where they would gather to sleep, breed, and feed.
All the horns for Indiana.
The collective state went on to report that soon Ohio, Illinois, Michigan, Kentucky, and Canada would all become Indiana. Persons close to Phoenix area friends Jake Welter and Mike Cefflin confirmed Friday that the two men are absolutely incapable of greeting each other like normal human beings.
Beep, 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 beep.
Sources say the two full-grown men simply cannot walk into a room and shake each other's hands, relying instead on elaborate dances, forced pop culture references, and extended fake fighting. Neither Welter nor Cefflin was available for comment as they were busy pretending to rip each other's faces off.
Did you know that you can listen to and watch Free Talk Live during our live show 7 days a week from 7 to 10 p.m. Eastern via our studio cam at cam.freetalklive.com? Not only that, but you can also chat with other listeners at the same time. Do I need to mention that both the studio cam and chat room are totally free? Outside of Free Talk Live's live hours, you won't see a cam feed, but we'll hear audio from the Liberty Radio Network. So listen, watch, and chat all free at cam.freetalklive.com. That's cam.freetalklive.com. LRN.FM needs your help getting our satellite signal back on in Africa. Our satellite provider had us on at no charge from 2012 through February of this year when they pulled the channel off the air. Now we're trying to raise $22,000 to continue reaching people with the message of liberty in places where it's needed most. Please visit our Indiegogo fundraiser at africa.lrn.fm. Give what you can and share the link with your friends. africa.lrn.fm.
You can interact with other LRN listeners in our message board at forum.lrn.fm. That's forum.lrn.fm.
Free Talk Live, 855-450-3733. It's 855-450-FREE. You can call in and talk about whatever's on your mind. We also have a Skype option for you if you want to sound a bit better. Usually, I mean, you know, depends on your setup. But you can call us LRN.FM as our username on Skype. You send us a contact request. We'll approve it in, you know, within a few minutes. And just do that. So that'll make it easy for you. It's LRN.FM on Skype and 855-450-FREE. On the telephone, Express Coin's the best choice for getting your cryptocurrencies, whether they're, you know, whatever you want to get, Bitcoin, Litecoin, Dogecoin. It's fast, safe, easy, and inexpensive. They're a licensed money services business. You can get your cryptocurrencies with a money order, check, or wire transfer. Just start off at expresscoin.com, whether you're in the U.S. or Canada. It's expresscoin.com. You can even do it from your smartphone by downloading the app at expresscoin.com. Had a guy interested in doing some online trading. And, you know, if you want to learn how to do the charts and all that stuff, those things apply just as easily in cryptocurrencies as they do anything else. And you can get in and do it with a lot less money with cryptocurrencies. So you can buy your first cryptocurrency with expresscoin.com and then send it to one of the exchanges, the ones that you trust. I've used BTC-E.com in the past, and, you know, I don't have any complaints, but your mileage may vary. I'm not recommending them, just saying what my experience has been. And the thing that's neat about cryptocurrencies is the exchanges never close. There's no closing of the Forex exchange. It's going on all the time. So it's expresscoin.com, and use coupon code FTL, and you can get up to $40 worth of the cryptocurrency of your choice with no fee. And even when you get more than $40 worth, it's
still quite a good deal. It's coupon code FTL. Going on with the article from The Guardian, polling about confidence in police is too occasional to draw direct correlations between the emergence of police brutality videos, such as the King beating footage, which was recorded on a Sony Handycam and is considered by many to be the first viral video, and changes in public opinion. But after 1995, with high-profile police killings and better data, public confidence in police among both black and white respondents took a 30-point plunge from which it has yet to recover. And police departments need to look at this. This is really important. This is something you can take steps to rectify. By that, I mean the police departments. They can do some things. I think that police wearing cameras that can't be tampered with by the individual officer, that is going to take a long step. I also think that footage should be loaded up directly onto the internet. I think that, we as the employers of these police officers should be able to see, it should be streamed right to the internet so we can see what our employees are doing. So I expect that's a little too much transparency for the government today, but I think that it's a good step. The proliferation of video technology with the standard inclusion of video cameras in iPhones after 2009 expanded the number of incidents of police brutality caught on tape. Many of the most prominent examples of police killings caught on video are from recent years.
I have another possible event.
What is it?
On October 3rd, 1995, the verdict was delivered in the O.J. Simpson trial.
Yeah, that's interesting, because I can tell you, white people really felt put out in the O.J. Simpson trial.
Right.
I remember being in prison when that was announced, and I saw the reaction. I worked in the staff canteen serving coffee to the police, and the officers, not very happy generally, especially, you know, the majority of the officers were white, not very happy with the verdict. But the inmates, overjoyed. Yay! I don't know. What does that mean? How would that affect it? You got me. Let's go to Troy calling in from Minnesota, see what Troy's got to say on this. Troy, you're on Free Talk Live.
Hi, guys. How are you guys doing tonight?
All's well. What's on your mind?
Well, you know, everybody, you know, and I mean, I understand what the officer did was wrong. But what about the responsibility of these people that are getting shot? Why don't they just comply with the officer's request? Why do they have to run? Why do they have to act like they do? I mean, if they just take some responsibility themselves and not put themselves and the officer into these situations, things would be a lot better.
It probably comes down to trust, would be my guess. Like, what you are saying, Troy, sounds extraordinarily white, right? Like, if you and I, and I'm going to go ahead and say that I don't self-identify as white, but I bet you everybody looks at me and says that. And because I don't claim a race, I think race is a silly conversation, but I get where, how it affects my life. I'm clear on that. The fact is that you and I have a reasonable confidence that we're not going to get our teeth kicked in if we just comply. But I would say that there's according to these numbers, a distinct lack of confidence. That's what these numbers say, is that 31% of blacks have confidence that the police are going to treat them well. That means that the vast majority don't.
Or do they just have a guilty conscience and they try to get away from the cops or cause problems with the officers when they get pulled over because they know they have warrants and stuff out for their...
You don't think 69% of blacks are like sort of these ghetto dwellers or something criminals, do you? I mean, the vast majority of black people are working for a living and, doing the same stuff we're doing all day long.
Right. But it goes down to basically common sense. If an officer tells you to do something, I don't care if you're black, white, Chinese, whatever. Comply with his request, and things will go a lot easier.
Have you seen the videos of the police beating the hell out of people who are in handcuffs?
Yeah, I've seen them. You know, and I mean, that's why we have attorneys to go back after them.
I don't want to take a punch from a police officer, and I don't have the money for an attorney, and I'm not interested in having my face brutalized.
I'm just saying, guys, a lot of times, it's better to comply than it is to try to run, because all you're doing then, too, is adding charges on, you know?
Well, I mean, it depends if you get away, right? Like, I mean, we just got some numbers that said police are the fattest job description out there.
Oh, yeah. I mean, can you imagine doing their job? And, I mean, I've got a lot of friends that are cops, and I've got a lot of friends that are in the construction business, as you know. And, I mean, it's like, okay, you're rolling out here in the middle of nowhere. You're by yourself in your squad. You pull somebody over. And it's like, okay, you don't know what type of situation you're walking up into. You got butterflies in your stomach. And it's like, okay, is this guy going to pull a gun out when I come walking up to the side of the car? How's this guy going to react? You know, I mean, I think what's going on out there, people have just lost respect for authority.
Exactly what we're talking about here. But it's, you got to stop blaming the people for it. The authority had the respect in 1981. Why did they lose the respect for the authority? It might have something to do with the authority.
And I think a lot of problems out there is you got a lot of these cops by themselves, these officers. When, think back in the day, most officers, there was two people in each squad car, there was two sheriffs in each car, and now they're by themselves. You know, if you have another person there with you, there was a lot less crap going on.
That could be it. You know? Thanks for the call, Troy. Appreciate it. 855-450-FREE. It's 855-450-3733. Will two cops in a car solve all our problems? Free Talk Live.
Hi, this is Steve Sanchez, and based on a recent study, it was found that 57 million Americans had legal issues over the last 12 months, but only 60% of those studied sought out the services of a lawyer. Why? In a nutshell, affordability. Well, my friends at Legal Shield have created a solution that can help you not if, but when you need an attorney. For as little as $17 per month, Legal Shield will provide you unlimited access to qualified attorneys at an accomplished law firm for advice and counsel on legal issues, no matter how serious or trivial. For over 40 years and with 1.4 million families across North America, Legal Shield can help you, the loyal GCN listener. Representatives are standing by now to answer your questions, so call them now at 1-855-340-SAVE. That's 1-855-340-7283, or visit them at lsprotection.com. That's lsprotection.com.
Results will vary from case to case.
What if the key to achieving liberty in your lifetime was to move together with others who think like you? Liberty activists are joining the Free State Project, which is over 70% of the way to its goal of 20,000 participants. And they're already making the move to New Hampshire. The successes are piling up and are proving the Free State Project is a real movement and no longer just a great idea. When you're planning your move, consider Keene. Keene is famous for its civil disobedience and non-cooperation, and there's plenty of political opportunity as well. From demonstrations and vigils to outreach and volunteering, there's a lot going on in Keene. Keene is the Liberty Media capital of the world, with television, talk radio, and more, all originating here. Though it's more than just activism, with regular social events each week. See what's happening at freekeene.com and get connected with video, audio, free books, a forum, and activist tools you can download and use in your area at freekeene.com. That's freekeene.com.
Did you know that Free Aid is a mutual aid, educational, and networking organization? At Free Aid, we support volunteers who provide first aid. We do outreach to the public about health and safety, and we bring together medically skilled freedom lovers. Free Aid is made possible by your generous support. Donors can receive great gifts like first aid kits, t-shirts, silver dime cards, and hoodies. The Free Aid Silver Dime Card Project is sponsored in part by Roberts & Roberts Brokerage, Freedom's Phoenix, and Don't Tread on Meme. Visit fr33aid.com.
The three most important things you can do for Free Talk Live are, one, share one episode a week on Facebook or in some other social networking site. Two, buy the things you buy online through shop.freetalklive.com. Three, give $5 a month to the AMP program. You likely buy all kinds of things online. Amazon is the largest online retailer. You can get what you need at the same prices with free Super Saver shipping by going to shop.freetalklive.com. Please do your online shopping at shop.freetalklive.com.
Since time began, tyrants have taken aim at personal liberties. Now there's a movie that aims back.
The government has no more right to tell us what to put in our bodies than they have to take our guns or tell us what books we can read.
Six drug police were eaten by bears while raiding a marijuana farm.
On your knees, you dirty hippies!
Jesus.
On your knees!
What's wrong?
problem, officer?
Today, many cops who enforce pot laws do so only because it provides them with cushy jobs, good benefits, and a chance to push people around.
I was an undercover narcotics officer. The drug war is nothing but a farce.
The Second Amendment says you gotta keep you and your gat intact.
Guns and Weed, The Road to Freedom. A film by Michael W. Dean and Nima Vadavi.
DVD available now at gunsandweed.com or on Amazon. That's gunsandweed.com. Makes the perfect gift. Remember, that's gunsandweed.com.
If you enjoy LRN.FM, please contribute to your favorite shows via their websites and become an amplifier at amp.lrn.fm. That's amp.lrn.fm.
Free Talk Live, 855-450-3733. It's 855-450-FREE. Why don't you write that number down? Get it in your phone so that when you want to call, you can do that. Because this is what happens, right? You think, well, I'd call, but I just don't know what the number is because I can't give it every minute. But if you take it down right now, 855-450-3733. It's been the same number for years. We did have an older one at one point, but you know, trust me, it'll be good for a long time. 855-450-FREE. Let's go to Chris calling in from Connecticut. Chris, you're on Free Talk Live. What's on your mind?
Hey, good evening, guys. This is Chris from the police state of Connecticut. And I do always remember 855-450-FREE. I've got that committed to memory at this point. I wanted to address the last caller.
If you don't have it committed to memory, you hate liberty.
It's an easy one.
Well, we try.
At any rate, the last caller is exhibiting like the classic slave mentality of comply or die. And, you know, this recent guy in South Carolina just basically died for a busted taillight. Was the root of it. And, you know, Eric Garner in New York died for a cigarette was the root of it. And this whole comply or die mentality, it makes me sick. It's basically a modern day equivalency in my mind of bowing your head before like King Henry VIII.
But if you didn't bow your head, the reason for bowing traditionally in Western cultures was essentially bearing your neck to the sovereign.
Yes.
That way the sovereign
yes.
could cleave your head from your shoulders. You were showing such yes. Fidelity to the state, in that point,
yes.
the sovereign individual.
Your spinal
that you
cord belonged to King Henry VIII. And I just
right.
want to address a second point of his, and that was...
Well, let me go on to the first one here real quick.
Yes, sir,
I'd say
yes, Mark. Go ahead.
The advice is sound. When when I've read stories written by, you know, folks from the black community talking about, you know, what to do when you get stopped. And the answer is say, yes, sir. You know, get your Sunday manners on and be polite.
Yes, officer.
Yeah. Say it over and over again. Because what it does is it signals. It's, you know, it's free, right? Like,
well, if you call them sir, you might get shot. You got to be careful.
Why is that?
Well, they like officer. It's an officiating title.
Nah, I've been every time I've dealt with somebody, it's a sir's been just fine, but you know, maybe your mileage may vary. So,
it has varied.
Yeah, this is reasonably good advice for getting the best result. It's just that at some point, you know, when people feel a little surly, things don't go so well, right? Like, and the question is in a free country, should an individual be able to feel surly without it being a death sentence? And I think generally, yeah, you should. Like a professional should be able to handle somebody who's, you know, not complying so well without killing them, without escalating the situation. Sometimes it's going to be necessary, but certainly not every time.
And I'd agree. From my experience, probably 50% of them do handle it pretty professionally when you call them sir and to kind of cover them. A second point I'd like to address Troy, the last cop living caller on. Was you say, you know, I wouldn't want their job. It's hard. You never know what you're going to get. And to that, I would say, well, yes, I wouldn't want their job either, because committing armed robbery, kidnapping, extortion, and ransoming on a daily basis is dangerous work. And whether you're doing it for
it's not dangerous. It's just not dangerous. I mean, everything
it's
not that you know, it's being a police officer is not dangerous. It's not even in the top 10 dangerous professions. You also have to. The most dangerous part of being a police officer is driving a car. Because they're on the road a lot, and driving is a dangerous task. The second most
regardless of that chart, Mark, the act of approaching somebody with a hand on a gun and basically robbing them potentially kidnapping, ransoming, extorting them under color of law, be it because you work for some kind of racketeering organization calling itself a municipal corporation, it's still robbery, extortion, kidnapping, etc., arose by another name, still arose, correct?
I'm not disagreeing with that part. I'm just disagreeing that it's dangerous. It's, you know, rare that you're dealing with a situation where police officers are sort of killed in the line of duty the way we think of it, in a hail of gunfire going down against the criminals. Especially since they're better.
On an individual basis, the act of robbing somebody, committing highway robbery, is a dangerous act. I mean, statistically, it might not bear out because people are so scared of him at this point and obedient and compliant, but it's still dangerous. So, yeah, I wouldn't want their job either, is all I'm saying. And to that, I'll yield the rest of my time, Mark.
You have more time? Thanks. You have the time I give to you, son. 855 450 free. Do you see it like Chris does? He claims that these police officers are committing robbery, essentially. And Mark Stevens called in and basically asked what gives them legitimacy. I think that we need protection services. Of that, there seems to be no doubt. We need, you know, life can be dangerous, right? Without police, there's probably you'll see an increase in crime, assuming, of course, accepting state crime, state-sponsored crime. And, could we do this in the free market? Is there any way that we can protect ourselves, you know, have the sort of protection we want in a free market? It seems like what policing organizations, these monopolies that are set up by municipal corporations, it seems like what they excel at is these malum prohibitum laws. Like, people can't do this thing or that thing. Drugs come to mind, all kinds of things that don't have victims. Basically, gambling, the possession of certain firearms, that kind of thing. Whereas we have security organizations already. I mean, you know, they don't have the power that police do, but they're able to protect things, and they have responsibility and culpability for their actions. I think that's kind of important. It says here, going on with the Guardian article, even audio footage of police killing people may make officers uncomfortable. Body camera studies have shown a decrease in the use of force by police officers, just for having body cams. And the officer in South Carolina appears to have been making claims over his radio, not knowing that he was being filmed. But such footage may not make white people trust officers any less. Even before the Garner killing, the gap in confidence in police expressed by white people and black people was at an all-time high, 27%, 27 points. This is confidence. In June 2014, 58% of white respondents said that they had a great deal or quite a lot of confidence in police, while only 31% of black respondents said so. Hispanics' attitudes about police have closely tracked the American average, according to Gallup. Black residents stood out in the Gallup data for varying attitudes about police, depending on whether they lived in an urban or non-urban area. For the years 2006 to 2014, 38% of black respondents from non-urban areas expressed confidence in police versus 26% from urban areas. That's a 12-point disparity. So even just living in a city, and it's true for whites too, not nearly as high. The gap of 12 points was far larger than the 5-point gap for Hispanic people and 2-point gap for white people living in urban versus rural areas. Let's go to Susan calling in from St. George, Utah. Susan, you're on Free Talk Live.
Hi.
Hey, what's on your mind?
I wanted to call in about this topic because my brother James Nolan Walker was a Navy veteran with an honorable discharge.
Okay.
And he was murdered by three sheriffs at Delta County, Colorado. There was a 911 call, and he had no criminal history. He was 39 years old in his front yard on his own land. He owned half the property, taking care of my mom. And we don't know if he had post-traumatic stress or what had happened. He had been in, on a ship, USS Forrestal, for 6 years in the Navy in the first Gulf War.
Uh-huh.
And he came back there, and that was in his younger years, and we don't know if he was having, like, a stress episode or whatever, but the neighbors had called thinking there was something domestic going on. My mother was elderly. He took care of her.
Yep.
And they they talked to him from 11:30 to 3:30, and then they brought in the SWAT, walked away, said there was no problem, and three of the officers got in position, and they shot him with two 308 sniper rifles and a 12-gauge shotgun.
Jeez.
And, they blew my brother. My brother was the most gentle person in the whole world. And
Susan, I'm sorry for your loss. Thank you for calling in on this. You know, this is what happens when, people that are untrained in dealing with mental health issues run up on mental health issues. It is what it sounds like. Obviously, we weren't there. We don't know what occurred, but something's got to change. There's far more people being killed in this country by police than there are in other Western civilized countries. 855-450-FREE. Free Talk Live.
New Hampshire is under quarantine as walking corpses devour the flesh of the living. Max is 11 years old and surviving alone. Slow-moving and non-thinking, the dead swarm his home. Now he must apply his Porcupine Freedom Scouts training to improvise his escape. Look for Survivor Max on Facebook, read reviews on Amazon, or read Chapter 1 at SurvivorMax.com.
Free Talk Live has partnered with Amazon, the largest internet retailer. Imagine a department store category, and Amazon has it. Books, electronics, office products, furniture, jewelry, automotive, toys, clothing, sporting goods, and dozens of other categories. Now you can shop and support Free Talk Live by entering Amazon through our website. Go to shop.freetalklive.com, and Amazon will send us a portion of your purchase. You're going to do the shopping anyway, so remember to enter through our site at shop.freetalklive.com. That's shop.freetalklive.com.
On the average, Americans work between 45 to 50 years, hoping to build up enough wealth to retire and live out their golden years. Unfortunately, with taxation, the rising cost of food, energy, housing, and medical, many retirees are forced to live below the poverty line. Is this a flaw for free enterprise, or is our monetary unit we call the Federal Reserve Note forcing us into perpetual debt, ensuring inflation and higher taxes? These questions and more can be answered by reading G. Edward Griffin's book, The Creature from Jekyll Island. Congressman Ron Paul states it's what every American needs to know about central bank power. A gripping adventure into the secret world of international banking cartel. Hi, this is Ted Anderson. I will give a silver dollar from the early 1900s to anyone who purchases this book. Call 1-800-686-2237 and order a copy today. It's critical that the public be made aware of the system. Call and order your copy today at 1-800-686-2237. That's 1-800-686-2237.
The warning signs.
At first, he made me feel special. He promised he'd look after me, provide for my future. He broke every promise he made.
Millions of Americans afflicted.
I was ready to leave, but he told me he'd change. So I gave him another chance. I was such a fool.
The consequences.
Things only got worse. He started making my decisions for me about my job, my kids' education, my money. My safety, my future. He took away my choices, but I kept going back to the same politicians.
The diagnosis? Battered voter syndrome.
I fell for the same old lies. They were just playing with my emotions, telling me what I wanted to hear. That's not right.
Stop the insanity of voting for the same old abusers. Declare your independence from the two-party system and join the New Hampshire Liberty Party today. At nhliberty.info. If you want to know the latest about Free Talk Live before we go on the air, all you need to decide is how you want it delivered. It's your choice. Visit news.freetalklive.com. You can get emailed announcements and participate in contests via our email updates list. Plus, we have a Twitter account that you can follow and a Facebook page where you can become a fan. So visit news.freetalklive.com to get news about Free Talk Live as soon as it's announced and the way you want it delivered. At news.freetalklive.com. That's news.freetalklive.com.
This is Mark of Free Talk Live. We've been witnessing a meltdown of the economic engine that powers our country. With a printing press tethered to Washington bureaucrats and New York central bankers, how can we trust paper money? For years, I've been buying gold and silver from Midas Resources, and you should too. Call 877-357-9938 for a free book titled 10 Reasons to Own Gold, or go to gold.freetalklive.com. Again, 877-357-9938. 877-357-9938.
You can put the Liberty Radio Network on the air in your area. Visit broadcast.lrn.fm to learn how. Broadcast.lrn.fm.
Free Talk Live, 855-450-3733. It's 855-450-FREE, committed to memory. You'll thank me. 855-450-3733. LRN.FM on Skype. We've been talking about sort of the disparity between whites and blacks and their confidence level with police, and the diminishing confidence level of all Americans in police over the course of the last three decades. And it's, it's interesting stuff. But there's no avoiding dealing with legal stuff in your life. Like it or not, you can't avoid this stuff. LegalZoom.com, however, can make it less painful and less costly by a good margin. So if you need legal forms, like maybe leases or a bankruptcy form or disability benefits, trademark, prenups, name changes, copyrights, deed transfers, leases, you can get them at LegalZoom.com. And you use coupon code FTL and you can save. So it's LegalZoom.com. Use coupon code FTL, save $10. And they make it a lot easier. I've got to say, I did my will over there, and they just ask you a series of questions, and they spit out the form. It's really relatively painless. LegalZoom.com, coupon code FTL. Let's go to Brian, listening in Nashua. Brian, you're on Free Talk Live. What's on your mind?
Hey, Mark, can you hear me okay? I'm on my Bluetooth.
Yeah, I think it sounds good.
Great. I want to call because not about this police shooting, but about victimless crimes. The reason why I want to call is because here on Free Talk Live, frequently the hosts of the show talk about victimless crimes, and I was wondering what the thoughts were about the concept of victimless crimes, as they're often called here, vis-a-vis the idea of whether or not there are crimes when society is the victim.
I think you've got to do, you got to go one better, but... why don't you give me the example? Are you thinking of something particular in your head that bothers you?
Yeah, specifically the situation, I believe it was in Atlanta, where 10 school teachers were falsifying the tests of students.
Sure.
And they ended up committing fraud. They got arrested. They're going to jail. And that's a situation where you look at it and you say, okay, well, the students, they all got passing grades or they got better grades as a result of the teachers falsifying their tests. The teachers were getting more pay because the students' test scores were linked to their performance on these standardized tests. And so you could look at it from a point of view of, there was really no victim in this case. But I would argue... which I don't think would be a predominant notion on from the host of Free Talk Live, that this would actually be a situation in which society really loses because you have kids being promoted through grades that probably should be kept back.
Okay, well, I'd take it from a different angle, I'd say there's a crime committed, and that crime is, first off, foremost, against those kids. Those kids are being treated as though they got better scores than they did, and that means that people are, the school system is going to treat them differently than what they need to be treated. This is assuming you have a good school system.
I disagree with you on that one.
But the fact is that society itself is damaged by the government school systems. I mean, when you're talking about the United States, public schools have been diminishing against in international standards over the years, and... basically, when you're talking about public schools, you're talking about the worst school in a given geographic area, and it's so bad we all have to fund it.
But you're generalizing. I mean about the specific case.
Specifically, those kids are the victims.
Okay. In this specific case, I think Mark has a point to say that the kids are the victims, but I think also, even more directly, the parents are the victims. And the parents are the victims in that they are paying to send their child to be educated at an institution that is lying about educating their children. Period. That's theft. That's fraud.
The parents and the children are the victims in this case.
Yeah, I'd also say the taxpayers of that given geographic area are victims too.
You would not say that in general when these students move on and presumably, let's suppose that they were given better grades than they really deserved throughout their entire careers for, maybe... This has happened systematically for years and years and years.
I think the point that we're skipping over here, and the only reason why this sort of fictitious situation...
No, this is factual situation.
Well, sure, factual situation, but it's sort of a fiction that's created that allows this weird sort of hypothetical to occur, which is that... there's no market signals here because it's government education. If I were to be going to college and they were giving me fake scores and I were paying for my own education, there'd be a very clear market signal that, hey, I want to learn what I can use to perform in the, you know, into the global marketplace to get a job, right? But that market signal doesn't exist because these kids are being forced to go to school and the costs are being hidden because they're forced to pay.
I don't know that I agree with that.
I agree with you that I agree that government schools are a tragedy and they're doing a big disservice to our country. But that being said, in this particular case with the students being promoted when they shouldn't be through the grades, in my opinion, this is something that is a crime against society.
Well, let me ask you this then, Brian.
Inevitable endpoint is that you have people who are being promoted through grades who should not be getting promoted through those grades. So you have people who don't know what they ought to know to be where they are. It's kind of like...
I got you, but let me ask you this. So in a private school, surely there's a private school teacher that has cheated in order to make her students' tests look better. Did she commit a crime against society or he?
Certainly, because that individual.
Well, I think that
is there anyone that would benefit from? Is there anyone in society that would benefit from children coming out with lower grades or with lower knowledge but higher grades?
I don't think so.
What if you're a drug dealer?
I don't know what you're precisely getting at, but
what I'm getting at is that society is a nonsense concept, and that there are some people who would appreciate students coming out dumber.
There certainly are. Most of them work for the government.
Well, Democrats do, certainly, but just in general, it's something that's horrible for our society.
What's society?
George Johnson, for God's sakes! Okay, so look, Johnson's right on the society thing, but he's sort of badgering you all the way through it, and I don't think that there's any point in that.
I'm playing the role of Ian.
Science, society benefits from lots of things, right? Like, society's better off that we know that fire exists. Society's better off that we have the wheel. Society's better off from a lot of things, including people getting good educations. And so, therefore, from a standpoint, I would say that public schools generally are a crime against society, but not necessarily the teachers in them. I would say, however, a teacher choosing to cheat is a tort against the students, against the parents who are paying, the funders, and the parents of those students. And in most cases, the funders and the parents are the same people. So, no, I don't consider it a crime against society because there's no one really to take up the banner.
It's interesting that you have that take because I hear what you're saying, but at the same time, I absolutely disagree. I think it hurts society. It hurts the other kids who are competing against that kid.
Yep.
No, nobody should get further.
But this is what society gets for having public schools. This is the society is getting its just desserts by creating a public school system in the first place.
Mark, do you think it doesn't matter if all the schools were private schools and this was also happening among the private schools, on a huge basis, it would be the same thing that society is getting idiots into positions where they shouldn't be higher up in higher grades.
Let me ask this question. I want to interject here, Mark, real quick. Sorry. I want to ask the question, do you think that it's a dangerous notion to think that you know what's best for society?
I think that everybody has ideas of what they think is best
they
for
sure
society.
They sure do! And you know what opinions are like.
It's like having referees give preferential treatment during sports games and when it's not fair, and I know life is unfair.
We need a level playing field!
Right. I would say that I benefit. Answer your question, Johnson. I benefit from teachers cheating in public schools because I am an advocate that public schools go away. And so when the natural consequence of these
dumb factories,
these forced test giving, these forced situations where teachers have to give tests is that at some point or another, people will give up on the concept of public schools, forcing the funding of the worst school in a given geographic area. So I benefit. How about that, Brian?
I get to benefit from these teachers. I want this to happen.
At the end of the day, there are a lot of stupid people who think that public schools, government schools, being taught that government is great, blah, 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 that that's great for society. But at the end of the day, we can all see that kids who are taught in private schools and homeschooled kids and other foreign countries, that they do a hell of a lot better of a job than our schools do. And yet we keep on falling away and away and away education-wise.
Brian,
despite the fact that we have so many college graduates.
Call me back with another one of these things where society gets hurt later, because I think they're an interesting question. I think it's keep mulling it over.
And consider stopping using the word our and we and society so much.
855-450-FREE. 855-450-3733.
Are you searching for your soulmate? Someone you can trust, who will never betray you or cooperate with the NSA? Stop searching. With EasyDNS, you found a keeper. EasyDNS does it all. Domain names, web hosting, and managed WordPress hosting. EasyDNS stands up for your internet freedom. And with servers in Canada, they do not cooperate with the NSA. Go to EasyDNS.com. You'll love their services or get a full refund. They guarantee it. And they accept Bitcoin. That's EasyDNS.com.
In a trial by jury, the primary function of a juror is not to dispense punishment to the accused. It is to protect your fellow citizens from being unjustly deprived of their life, liberty, or property. As a juror, you can say no to unjust laws and prevent government abuses of power by refusing to convict. Legislative, executive, judicial. The fourth branch of government is we the people. Find out more from the Fully Informed Jury Association at fija.org.
Radio is the most personal of mediums. I exist right now in your head. If you listen to Free Talk Live regularly, you know me. Free Talk Live is on more than 160 radio stations around the U.S. and has been downloaded on every continent around the world. Hundreds of thousands of listeners with ad packages from $600 a month to $6,000 a month. Imagine what we can do for your business, project, website, or idea. Email me, mark@freetalklive.com. Here's a chance to do a little activism while you're cruising Facebook, Twitter, or Google+. Between the LOL cats, the recipes, the hot girls, and the inspirational sunrise memes, Free Talk Live's posts pass by your newsfeed. Like them. Comment. It gives us more exposure. If you don't see our posts, click like at facebook.freetalklive.com and then hover over it to click get notifications. It's an easy way to spread the ideas of liberty a bit further. I know you're busy, but you can spare that tenth of a calorie it takes to click on something. facebook.freetalklive.com.
You're listening to the live edition of Free Talk Live. Hour number three is next after the news here on the Liberty Radio Network at LRN.FM.
From Keene in the Shire, the Liberty Media capital of the world, this is Daryl W. Perry, host of FPP Radio News for Thursday, April 9th, 2015. Silver is trading at $16.33 per ounce. Gold is valued at $1,200 per ounce. And according to BitcoinAverage.com, the average price of Bitcoin is $244. Antiwar.com reports, despite years of haranguing from the U.S. and threats to sanction Pakistan, the Iran-Pakistan natural gas pipeline will finally be built by Chinese company CNPC, according to reports. Initially floated as an Iran-Pakistan-India pipeline, the project has been pushed as a way for Pakistan to solve decades of crippling energy shortages that have led to intermittent blackouts in major cities. India withdrew from the project in 2009, saying the prices negotiated were no longer attractive. Pakistan still wanted and needed the gas, but the U.S. State Department has repeatedly threatened to impose crippling economic sanctions on them for daring to do business with Iran. The insertion of a Chinese company into the situation changes it dramatically and seems to be the result of the latest framework deal with Iran and a planned easing of sanctions. As a permanent U.N. Security Council member, China is in a much better position to thumb their nose at idle U.S. threats over the pipeline. And given recent diplomatic progress, it will be difficult for the U.S. to even try to retaliate over the matter. For over 35 years, Robertson Roberts has been a trusted source for buying and selling your investment-grade precious metals. They also take Bitcoin for precious metal purchases and permanently removed the minimum purchase order for all orders paid in the digital currency. Call Robertson Roberts today for knowledgeable advice on investing and a forward-thinking approach to new technologies. 850-478-5270 or online at rrbi.co. UPI reports a Texas federal judge refused to lift a temporary block on a White House immigration plan that would defer deportation for up to 5 million people in the country illegally. U.S. District Judge Andrew Hanen rejected a request by the federal government that he stay his February 16th decision, which granted a preliminary injunction blocking President Obama's executive action. He said the government has not shown any credible reason why the order needed to be set into action immediately. Texas and 25 other states, largely Republican, sued to stop Obama's action, saying it was a constitutional overreach of power and would force them to spend more on law enforcement, health care, and education. Hanen wrote in the order, "There is no pressing emergent need for this program. If there had been such a need, the Department of Homeland Security could have implemented the program at any time in the last 5 or even 10 years. In November, Obama signed the order that also granted benefits to some parents of legal residents and citizens. The move has become a flashpoint across the nation. The U.S. Department of Justice also appealed the matter to the 5th U.S. Circuit Court of Appeals. Oral arguments are set to begin April 17th. On Tuesday, Hanen also said the administration misled him when it revealed last month the federal government had issued expanded worker permits to some 100,000 workers in the country illegally before the court blocked the program from beginning. He told the government to supply more information on the issue by April 21st. When her plush and comfy life suddenly and unexpectedly fell apart, Brooke and her dog Cloud set out to defy the odds. If this is a man's world, as they say, living on the streets is no place for a young woman. One day she awoke in the Redwood Forest and realized she had become a hobo, and would ultimately come to know exactly what it means to survive. How to Be a Hobo by Brooke Willett is available from Amazon.com and all major bookstores. Reuters reports Boston Marathon bomber Zokhar Tsarnaev's conviction on Wednesday came as a relief to residents of the city of Boston, though many expressed mixed feelings over whether the 21-year-old should be put to death for his crimes. Tsarnaev was found guilty in federal court of killing 3 people and injuring 264 others by detonating twin bombs at the finish line of the world-famous race in 2013. The jury will now decide whether Tsarnaev should be executed. After the verdict was read, bombing survivor Karen Broussard said at a news conference that she and other survivors were grateful for the guilty verdict, but she said the survivors also had differing views on whether Tsarnaev deserves the death penalty. Massachusetts scrapped the death penalty in 1984, but capital punishment is still available in cases that are under federal jurisdiction. This has been FPP Radio News, online at fppradio.com.
Seniors thunder into a local high school parking lot like coalition forces entering Baghdad. A substitute teacher just needs to make it to her car before breaking down in tears. And a college freshman tells his roommate there's no need to hide his masturbation from him. And now a week in review that truly requires no introduction. The nation's students announced this week that they have reluctantly agreed to give the American education system yet another chance, saying they hope educators keep their promises of smaller class size, better school supplies, and intensified efforts to raise the country's international math ranking. The nation's students vowed to give the education system one more shot, despite claiming to have been burned many, many times in the past. In other news, a man overcomes alcoholism without the help of Jesus, and an outcast student and a lonely teacher have begun a somewhat endearing sexual relationship. And that was a free lesson in top-shelf journalism. For more news, videos, and reminders of your insignificance, visit theonion.com/newsbeat.
This is the Onion News Network.
Free Talk Live, 855-450-FREE. It's 855-450-3733. You can call in, talk about whatever you'd like to here. We also have LRN.FM. That's our username on Skype, so you're welcome to call us there. That's LRN.FM is our username. You'd have to send a contact request first. It usually takes us a few minutes to take care of that, and then you can call us in and sound a bit better. 855-450-FREE. It's Mark.
And Johnson.
Hey, I'm Ian.
Oh, Ian's here. Did you save all of us from parking increases?
For the moment, yes. So for those just tuning in, I was out tonight because there was a meeting at the Keene City Council Chambers to propose to raise the parking rates.
From what to what?
Well, there's a bunch of different rates. I'm not going to go through it all. So,
by
like,
what
they
percentage?
They want to raise the ones that you pay monthly. They want to raise the ones that you pay by the minute as well. So the people who, you know, like the people that live in downtown.
About what percent?
They're going to do
double in a lot of areas, and they also want to do double the fine in a lot of
areas. They
want to
double the fine. That's for sure.
From $5 to $10.
From $5 to $10. Now, a lot of people out there listening, they're laughing right now, saying
$10.
Oh, $10.
It's $70 here in New York, or whatever.
I think it's $85 in New York now.
Yeah. So, I mean, look, I understand that Keene has it better than a lot of places, but the economy's smaller here too.
Way smaller. This type of town.
Median income in New Hampshire is among the top of all 50 states.
Yeah, but this, out here, there's a lot of poor people that live out here in Cheshire County, and I'm sorry that parking rate increases are going to hurt the poor people more so. And I forgot to make this point in front of the city. I'll have to do that in 2 weeks when they have another meeting about this. But if you think about it, if you make $100,000 a year and you get a $10 parking ticket instead of a $5 parking ticket, it's not the end of the world for you. But if you're making $20,000 a year and you're barely getting the bills paid at the end of the month and you're trying to put food in your kids' mouths, then $5 to $10 can make the world of a difference, especially if you're living downtown and you get these tickets regularly, or you're working downtown and you get these tickets regularly. So it was nice to see that on relatively short notice, there were a fairly decent number of people who came out. I would say about 10 people testified tonight, which isn't a whole bunch of folks, but it's more than, zero or three. And so there were probably about 5 liberty activists that came out to testify on this, and then about 5 other folks, a couple of city councilors, and then a couple of business owners as well that came out. And it was actually surprising that one lady who owns a business downtown, she owns a candy store, which is a great store. But she was against the parking rate increases last year. So the pretty much the same proposal was brought out last year. There's been a few things that have been changed, but pretty much the same idea of just to raise rates across the board and raise the parking fines as well. And so this lady opposed it. In fact, she even signed a petition against it last year, along with dozens of downtown merchants saying, we don't want this. It's already tough enough. We already get enough complaints from our customers who are upset about getting ticketed just for trying to go to a downtown business. We don't need to have worse fines. And
did they raise it last year?
No, they actually took it off the table last year, and now it's back after an entire year of it just sort of floating out there and not coming back. Now all of a sudden it came back.
It'll be back again.
Well, it's coming back in 2 weeks. They put it on for more time so they can hear from more people in more members of the public. But anyway, this lady, this business owner who was against it last year, she sounded like she'd sort of begrudgingly come around. She said that the parking czar, as he's been called, and this is the city's name for
this
guy.
Doesn't sound like he does anything worth anything.
He's been lobbying for this. So he's gone to the city, downtown business group. There's an association of downtown businesses, and he's been coming to their meetings, and she says he's been coming to more of the meetings than the average business owner from downtown.
But he'll stop as soon as he gets what he wants.
Sure, of course. So he's been lobbying hard for this, and she was saying that she'd been she felt like she'd been heard, that she'd been validated, that their concerns had been validated, and she seemed like she was sort of begrudgingly supporting this on the speculative idea that, well, if the city raises these rates, they're going to get this extra revenue because they have these projections, right? Like, oh, if we raise the rates to this, then after 3 years we'll have this much money coming in, which of course presumes that the same or more people will be coming downtown. They don't figure that, the rates are going to go up so fewer people will come downtown, which of course is true. I mean, some people are going to draw the line here. They're going to say,
that's how pricing works, right?
Right. They're going to say, well, why would I go shopping in downtown when I can go to Walmart or Target or something like that?
Where parking is free and I don't have to worry about getting a ticket and getting told, you're a bad person. You didn't pay enough attention.
Right. So she's hoping that if the Downtown Business Association supports this, that the city will get enough revenue from the increased parking fines and rates that they'll build them a parking garage on the speculative idea.
They run in the red all the time
anyway. They're saying this will bring them out of the red.
All they're trying to do is pay for their own salaries.
They also claim this pays for beautification of downtown. And as I pointed out, well, if people want to beautify downtown, then the business owners themselves could do that. You know, you don't need the parking department for this.
Right.
Let the business owners have the spaces, or let the property owners have the spaces that are adjacent to their properties in downtown, and let the market decide these things. I said that would be the best choice. The next best choice is
But Ian, we need compliance on the historic district. All they need to have the same bushes, that regulatory height of 6.578 inches.
Well, they didn't come back with that objection, but you know, one of the classic objections is, well, we need turnover. That's why the parking meters exist. We need turnover. And I said, well, there's towns in New Hampshire that don't have them, and they have, you know, downtowns with businesses. And
I'm thinking back when I lived in Connecticut, where there were towns with, like, much larger economies than here in Keene that, you know, made a lot more money, had much higher-end businesses, and don't have parking like this.
They don't have parking meters?
No, they don't have parking meters at all.
It would have been good to have you there testifying on this.
Yeah, well.
But, you know, the more evidence these guys can get, the better. I mean, I understand some people are going to say, look, this isn't worth your while, Ian. Why are you going and talking to these bureaucrats? I mean, a lot of them don't even want to look at me when I'm talking to them.
No, they hate you.
The elected politicians, they won't even make eye contact with me. But nonetheless, it's not just, by the way, for the politicians. When you go to these meetings, there's media there. So the local newspaper, the local radio station, and very often, especially in the newspaper article that'll likely be written about this meeting, the bulk of the article is going to cover this because this took up the bulk of the meeting. They went through a bunch of other stuff relatively quickly, and then this was, what time did I get here? Like 8:50. So, I mean, this was literally from, say, 7:15 on through 8:30 or something.
Sure, it was
like
riveting.
That. And so the lady who's writing the newspaper articles, she's going to summarize some of the things that we said, we being the liberty activists that came out there. There's also a cable access channel here in Keene that the government meetings they're aired on. So there are certain people who they don't want to come out to the meeting, but they might actually watch it air live or air in delay broadcast later on television. And so the ideas will get into their heads as well. So it's also an outreach project. You're not just outreaching to the city councilors, but you're outreaching to anyone who's paying attention. And it was also kind of nice to have at least one person from Stop Free Keene who was on the same page as the activists from Free Keene in this particular meeting. There was a lady who I recognized her name. I'd seen it in Stop Free Keene before, which is this local group of sort of counter-activists, people that want to excise the liberty activists from
Stop
town.
Free parking! Well, we hate this idea!
In this case, she was against the proposed increase, so good. She was on the same page. I mean, not on the exact same points, not for the same reasons necessarily, but she runs a hair salon in downtown Keene. It's a relatively new salon, and of course, you know, there's customers who are complaining. And if you're spending, it's a salon,
she
right?
She must not be towing the party line. I'm sure the rest of Stop Free Keene would be like, we need to install parking meters in the big lot stores. Each space needs to be metered at the Walmart parking lot.
Honestly, I don't know. I don't read Stop Free Keene very often. It's maybe once a month that I'll go in there now. So I did not check to see what the consensus was. But it was nice to see that, you know, again, politics makes for strange bedfellows sometimes, right? And, you know, I'll support whoever's right on this particular issue. Of course, there were hundreds of people who've signed a petition within just the last 24 hours. There was 140 people who signed a petition opposing this, and a couple of years ago there were over 600 plus petition signatures that we gathered in person. So the 140 petitions was an online change.org petition put up by one of the downtown merchants, and so that was given to the councilors tonight on, again, relatively short notice. It was put on the table. It was put on for more time. There's going to be another meeting about it in 2 weeks. It's nice to see all this pushback happening, and it's not just from people in the Liberty community. This is one of the nice things about being in New Hampshire, is it's hard for government to increase its size here in New Hampshire. People care about freedom here.
They are more active. 855-450-3733. It's 855-450-FREE.
So the protection of life, liberty, and property is what the Free State Project is all about. But it's an effort to move 20,000 people who understand.
It's about demonstrating to the entire country
that, yeah, we can have a free market, a truly free market.
Making it just a freer, great place to live.
It's the world's largest voluntarist libertarian community, and it's only getting bigger.
That's amazing, to be able to move to a place where other people like passionately believe in being free and independent.
What the Free State Project is managing to do, though, is to put their money where their mouth is. It's physically getting up across the country and saying, let's go someplace and let's demonstrate the power of these ideas. There's a lot of kind of philosophy that surrounds liberty. There's a lot of thinking about it and talking about it. But here in New Hampshire, people are doing it.
101 Reasons Liberty Lives in New Hampshire, a documentary by Free State Project Early Movers. Watch it free at 101reasonsfilm.com. 101reasonsfilm.com.
Making the right decisions is a challenge to investors. Are we going to see economic growth slide into a recession or, at worst, depression? Hi, Ted Anderson from Midas Resources. We all know when a company acts irresponsibly, divesting ourselves in a move towards safety is prudent. When the market becomes volatile, U.S. treasuries are a safe haven. But what do you do when the U.S. government overextends itself and spends beyond its means? Many investors are turning toward gold as a common-sense alternative to traditional paper investments. Midas Resources has put together a powerful book titled 10 Reasons to Own Gold, discussing costs, benefits, risks, featuring full-color illustrations, weights, and measures. The book is free and can be yours by calling 800-686-2237. Paper investments are dwarfed by gold's 6,000-year history. Discover how gold may be right for you and your IRA by calling 800-686-2237. Whether buying or it's time for you to sell, the book is free. Call 800-686-2237.
Why did you move to the Shire?
I moved here to the Shire because there's other people around who take liberty just as seriously as I do.
I moved to the Shire because I saw videos of people challenging authority and thought that I could get support myself. It called to me, like, do this right now.
I wanted to be around people like me who got it. And once I got here, I knew there was nowhere else that I wanted to be.
I've always wanted to change the world. So I moved to the Shire to join people who were actually working towards doing the same thing.
The people here are awesome, loving, and positive. It was for the adventure and for the feeling of something important is happening here, and I just wanted to come to sort of be part of that.
Visit ShireSociety.com to read and sign the Shire Society Declaration and learn the reasons why, if you love liberty, you should immigrate to the Shire. Plus, add yourself to the Shire map at ShireSociety.com. That's ShireSociety.com. So you've heard all 3 hours of the latest episode of Free Talk Live, and you're still hungry for liberty-oriented audio content? Did you know that we have another 24/7 audio stream at LRN.fm? The Liberty Radio Network airs the latest episodes of some of the best liberty-oriented podcasts on the internet, around the clock. In addition to recorded content, you'll also hear live shows like Free Talk Live, originating from our Keene, New Hampshire studio. So listen anytime at LRN.fm. That's LRN.fm.
If there was a place that liberty-minded people had been elected to political positions and were rolling back government, would you move there? If freedom lovers had secured a 20% voting block and can veto most bad bills, would you move? Well, the time has come to sign the pledge at freestateproject.org. These things have happened in New Hampshire, and you can join us and help. freestateproject.org. Sign up now at freestateproject.org.
You can connect with the Liberty Radio Network via our Facebook page at facebook.lrn.fm. That's facebook.lrn.fm.
Free Talk Live, 855-453. It's 855-450-3733. You can call in, talk about whatever's on your mind. This live edition of Free Talk Live. It's Mark with you.
And Ian.
And Johnson.
855-450-FREE. Ian, you've been using the Pocket Power Plus to charge your phone and do all kinds of other stuff as far as equipment goes, charging equipment.
I've actually only been using it to charge my phone.
Yeah.
It works well for that. I suggested last night, Mark, that we should see how many days we can go for here just charging the phone with the Pocket Power Plus. So that's what I'm actually in the process of doing right now. It's a great little device, and it is a breakthrough in portable power technology. It's the Pocket Power Plus. You can go to pocketpowerplus9.com to get it at half price and use coupon code FTL to save even more. It's a great source of backup power, and it's small enough to where you can actually fit it in your pocket, leave it in your glove box in the car if you want. In fact, it's so powerful that in some circumstances, it can even jumpstart a car. So whether you're stranded somewhere, maybe it's in an airport or you're, you know, in your car driving for a long while, or you just want to go off grid for a while, the Pocket Power Plus becomes your own personal mini power plant. You can run devices, electrical power hungry devices, for hours and even days if you need to. So go and check out the Pocket Power Plus over at PocketPowerPlus9.com. And again, use coupon code FTL to save even more on the Pocket Power Plus. PocketPowerPlus9.com. And I believe they give you discounts further if you buy multiples. So, like, you know, you want to get them for gifts for your family, you can buy a pack of them.
How many milliamp hours is that? Do we know?
I think it's 12,500, nice, if I'm recalling correctly. And it also has 12 volt on it. So, again, that's how you – it comes with an accessory pack that has a bunch of adapters in it. So it's likely going to fit, like, right out of the box. It's, you're going to be able to plug in likely your electronic device. And it even comes with the jumper cables. So
most of them won't do, even the ones that are in competition, right, with this, won't do a laptop.
Some do, yeah, but most of them are made specifically for phones.
Correct, yeah. This one has a 19-volt output on it for laptops, and it also has a 5-volt output with USB.
The nice thing, too, about that, looking at it, is that, you know, some of the competition doesn't have ports built right in. You have to get, like, all these series adapters. Right. And it's like you might not have the adapter, and they're small, you lose them. And it's like that has them built right into the side, so that's really nice.
It's pretty handy. I've been liking it so far. PocketPowerPlus9.com.
Yep, coupon code FTL.
That's correct.
So, Ian, you brought in some show prep that is a little bit macabre, perhaps. Macabre?
Macabre, I believe, is how you pronounce that. It's about a hoarder, which I just find that a particularly fascinating variant version of crazy. Mummified hoarder has been removed from San Francisco home. According to sfgate.com, San Francisco fire officials removed a body Saturday evening from a home on 4th Avenue in the Richmond District 3 days after authorities were alerted to debris stacked so densely inside the property that entry to the front door was almost entirely blocked. Firefighters wearing oxygen masks went in through a front window, wrapped the body in a white sheet, and placed it onto a gurney before carrying it away. One of the firefighters was heard saying to a San Francisco Medical Examiner official, quote, "It's mummified, lightweight, wrapped in a blanket." San Francisco Police, Fire, and Medical Examiner's officials all declined to comment on the case on Saturday night. Neighbors, however, described how authorities first visited the home on Tuesday.
Yeah, you'd think that this, I mean, I grew up on a farm, and I can tell you when a large animal dies, it's pretty awful in the immediate vicinity as far as...
Yeah, but if the doors and windows are closed, then you're not going to smell that next door, are you?
Well,
no way.
I mean, where's the smell go?
It stays in the house.
Sealed
in.
I guess that's what happened.
I mean, if there's going to be very, very little air that's escaping, right? I mean, every window does have some allowance of air through it, right? To some extent, a very small amount. But newer windows, not so much compared to older ones.
Yeah.
And, you know, if all the windows are closed and the doors are closed, there's a good chance no one would know. So anyway, going on here. The police visited this particular address, and what they found was a mess so extensive. It was, according to one neighbor, a neighbor who declined to be named, quote, "Hoarders 101, or even worse than the TV show." Have either of you seen Hoarders, the TV show?
Yes.
A couple of times, yeah. I mean, I've seen some episodes.
It's fascinating. I find that show very entertaining. I don't watch it regularly, but every now and then, I like to watch it.
It's kind of because you're like the opposite.
Well, I mean, it helps motivate me to not become like that.
Yeah.
Do you normally want to keep things like that?
No, absolutely not. But
so that's what I'm saying. You're the opposite.
Well, but it motivates me in that direction. Like, you know, if I feel messier when I watch Hoarders, and I want to clean myself and my living conditions.
Throw
even
some
further.
Crap away. Yes.
Yeah. Exactly. So
the problem is you can consider just about everything crap.
A homemaker who lives two doors away said a woman named Carolyn lived at the home with her elderly mother and with a dog that she took for daily walks. The mother had not been seen for several years. The homemaker, who also declined to be identified, said a man living in an in-law unit at the house was informed on Tuesday the property was in foreclosure and that the younger woman, Carolyn, would be taken to a hospital. Authorities did not identify the residents and would not confirm if the body removed from the home
was
that.
Someone was living in there?
Someone was in an in-law unit.
What about Carolyn?
Probably means someone who enters through a separate door.
Sure.
Who doesn't actually go into the other area.
What about Carolyn?
They would not identify the residents and would not confirm if the body removed from the home was that of the elderly mother or not, or the younger lady. Another neighbor, a lawyer who would identify...
Said that Carolyn was going to hospital.
Yeah, I'm not really sure. I guess... I don't know. I'm not sure if she was going to the hospital because she was dead or what the deal
I suppose
was.
That would be a reason to go to the hospital, right?
But another... I guess you don't take dead people to the hospital. That's the morgue. Anyway, another...
Sometimes the morgue is at the hospital.
Yeah.
Good point. Another neighbor, a lawyer who would identify himself only as Michael, said employees from the city's Department of Public Works arrived Wednesday and began removing debris from the home, filling several trash bins before seeking assistance. He said, quote, a police officer outside the house told me they'd found rats, black widow spiders, 300 bottles of...
urine.
You got it! Now,
it's the way of the future. It's the way of the future. Reason... The way of the future. The way of the future. The way of the future.
What does that
mean? I don't
mean?
Get that
the
joke.
Future,
the way of I don't the future. Get it.
Oh, it's the... You guys have never seen The Aviator. Leonardo DiCaprio stars as playing Howard Hughes, and Howard Hughes lost his mind and became completely obsessive compulsive and started collecting his own urine jars.
Oh, my.
And in this movie, Leonardo DiCaprio at one point... You know, Howard Hughes is giving some sort of speech where he's talking about airplanes or something like that, and he starts saying it's the way of the future, and then he just continues. He's like, "It's the way of the future. It's the way of the future."
He was talking about airplanes, not collecting.
Sure, yeah, and he just, but he just starts getting like faster and faster and faster and faster, and it's actually really impressive how Leonardo DiCaprio starts saying this very, very, very quickly.
Now, of course, the reason why this lady was collecting bottles of urine was likely because she couldn't get into the bathroom. That's my speculation on that.
Yeah. Okay.
Hoarding, of course, over time becomes more and more extreme. And, you know, unless somebody intervenes in that situation, it's going to get to the point where you can't even get to the toilet.
Yeah, I used to be a taxi cab driver and would have to take sometimes people who needed to go to doctor's appointments and stuff would get city assistance. And I would have to go sometimes into their homes and help them. I saw a woman who basically only had half a bed. You know,
because of junk piled on it.
Just could you walk from the bed to the bathroom to the kitchen?
Do you have a hoarder experience? We'd love to hear from you at 855-450-FREE, 855-450-3733. It's Free Talk Live.
So we decided to upgrade the look of our home.
You know, improve the curb appeal.
We decided to add the look of stone to the exterior.
We really like the stacked stone look.
Yeah, but when I checked into the price, it was ridiculous. No way could we afford it.
Then a friend told me about Genstone. Genstone.
Genstone comes in lightweight panels made of polyurethane. They've actually engineered the hassle out of installation. No mortar, no mesh. It was easy. Even I could do it.
We just screwed the panels to the wall and it looks like stone. I mean, it really looks like stone.
Yeah, from the box to the wall in minutes.
We love the look of our home now.
And Genstone is durable, comes with a 25-year warranty, and offers additional R-value for insulation.
If you want the look of stone at a price you can afford, call Genstone.
At 855-955-STONE. Trust me, you'll save money.
And you'll love the look.
855-955-STONE. That's 855-955-7866.
So the protection of life, liberty, and property is what the Free State Project is all about. But it's an effort to move 20,000 people who understand.
It's about demonstrating to the entire country
that, yeah, we can have a free market, a truly free market.
Making it just a freer, great place to live.
It's the world's largest voluntarist libertarian community, and it's only getting bigger.
That's amazing, to be able to move to a place where other people like passionately believe in being free and independent.
What the Free State Project is managing to do, though, is to put their money where their mouth is. It's physically getting up across the country and saying, let's go someplace and let's demonstrate the power of these ideas. There's a lot of kind of philosophy that surrounds liberty. There's a lot of thinking about it and talking about it. But here in New Hampshire, people are doing it.
101 Reasons Liberty Lives in New Hampshire, a documentary by Free State Project Early Movers. Watch it free at 101reasonsfilm.com. 101reasonsfilm.com.
This Your Family Today tip is brought to you by Stouffer's, helping bring your family together with wholesome dinner options, even on the busiest of nights. Find dinner table ideas to bring your family together at letsfixdinner.com. To get kids involved in dinnertime conversation, ask specific questions, not broad ones. Instead of what happened today at school, try what was the best thing that happened today. The more specific you are, the more they'll have to say. For more tips like these, visit us at parenthood.com/yourfamilytoday.
Free Talk Live has partnered with Amazon, the largest internet retailer. Imagine a department store category, and Amazon has it. Books, electronics, office products, furniture, jewelry, automotive, toys, clothing, sporting goods, and dozens of other categories. Now you can shop and support Free Talk Live by entering Amazon through our website. Go to shop.freetalklive.com, and Amazon will send us a portion of your purchase. You're going to do the shopping anyway, so remember to enter through our site at shop.freetalklive.com. That's shop.freetalklive.com.
Because we are smothering in spam, please do not reply to all when you can instead reply. I was recently among over 100 invited to a corporate reunion. It's always a warm affair, and that's the problem. Enthusiasm for our upcoming get-together caused many recipients to RSVP the organizer with a cheery reply to all. I can't wait. Then others piled on with a reply to all to that. Then the I'm out of my office now autoresponders joined in. So I replied to all, asking that we all reply only to the organizer. Hey, at least I tried. One invitee, apparently retired, shot back, point taken, but I really like seeing the responses since they're so positive. Smiley face. This better be an open bar. From SurvivalSpeech.com, I'm Holland Cook.
While our satellite channel is free to listen to, it's not free for us. You can help us cover our satellite costs with the chip-in on the right side of the page at LRN.FM.
Free Talk Live, 855-450-3733. It's 855-450-FREE. You can call in and talk about whatever's on your mind. It's Mark with you.
Ian here.
And Johnson.
If you want to get some free episodes of Free Talk Live going back for many years, go to archives.freetalklive.com. We make it possible for you to go there and download whatever ones you want. It's easy and it's free. It's archives.freetalklive.com. Ian, so we were just talking about this mummified individual that was found in San Francisco with apparently, besides a whole bunch of hoarded stuff, 300 bottles of urine.
You know, one of my favorite Free Talk Live promos is you guys have talked in the past about hoarders. And one of them in the past is it runs on the air every so often. And it's you guys talking about hoarders. And Mark, at one point you jump in and you say, you know, it's nothing that a good coat of fire wouldn't fix.
It's the first thing I said when I saw the studios of 105.9 WYNF, where Ian and I met and worked for years. Not just the studios there, but the whole studios of what we called Radio First, right. Clear Channel affiliate in Sarasota. And oh my God, it was awful.
I do feel like sometimes some of these hoarder situations really would be best remedied by a controlled, very hot burn.
Yeah, the problem is when you're looking at something like this, is this house is right next to.
Yeah.
Like, you might be able to squeeze between these two houses if you tried real hard, but it's right next to another house. And I think that pretty much you just have to knock them down.
I mean, in a lot of these situations, I mean, the just disgusting stuff that they leave around ends up in rot in the wood.
Well, yeah, that's one of the other things that happened here in this particular house. Ugh. So not only did they find, and again, this is
bugs.
This is a very short list, I'm sure. Rats, black widow spiders, 300 bottles of urine, and mold on the walls. Ugh. So yeah, when somebody's not cleaning and they're just throwing all kinds of garbage everywhere, it's not a surprise when, you know, the house becomes infested with mold or bugs, rats in this case. And I remember one of these hoarders' houses that they showed on the hoarders' television show, they had some sort of a bed bug infestation, and it just wasn't going to get cleaned. There was just if they had a laundry in that house, you couldn't get to it. I mean, there was no chance that bed bug infestation was going to be gotten rid of until the entire house was cleaned out, which of course is a tremendous effort. And then if mold's been, you know, ruining the fixtures and the walls and things like that, it really, you know, a coat of fire could be the solution
Maybe
to a situation
a really
like that.
Maybe a really strong acid. Like, just melt it into the ground. Just burn it away. Dissolve everything.
Well, people put okay. So when you're doing a building, the real phase where the contractor sort of impresses people is the build out, right? Like when you first get the structure up,
right?
But that's not it at all. So when you see some old factory building that's nothing but bricks, a structure with bricks. It's really not worth anything because it has to be re-outfitted with electrical and insulation
and
plumbing.
It's just a shell, yeah.
Yeah, and all these things. There's not that much value to something like that other than sort of the tax savings that you get from not having to come up to code if you do a renovation as opposed to a new build. So really the only value when you see a structure that's destroyed like this, because you know, doing this will destroy a structure.
Right.
Is essentially they leave enough of the old structure up in order to be able to save, rather than having to come up to code.
Right.
The real tragedy about this. I mean, it's easy to laugh at the hoarding situations. There's just some absurd stuff that goes on there, and it's a funny but yet sad thing all at the same time because this is a human being. I mean, these are somebody's mom or dad or a sister or brother and friends or whatever. And a lot of them, they know they have a problem. And they, for instance, they won't allow friends to come over. They'll always have a reason why, my roommate's home. Or they'll have some sort of excuse to why you can't come hang out at their house or come to Thanksgiving dinner there. And they always want to go out to meet people. So many people probably don't even know, which friends you have or which family members you have who are hoarders unless you've been in the house to see it. You may not know because they may not keep their like, for instance, if they've got a cubicle in the office, maybe they've got that okay, but right. the house looks completely different. And this is a serious mental disorder. It's a serious problem. And
when you're dealing with one, even if you live in the house, it can be really debilitating. So,
my God, I can't imagine living with a hoarder.
Well, these folks don't want to throw anything away, and it gets very difficult to get things out of their hands.
I felt like I've lived in almost partial hoarding situations multiple times, twice in Florida.
Yeah, so. I saw part of that.
So
once.
I've got pictures and documentation of both of those situations, actually.
And like, what do you do when you're dealing with somebody who doesn't clean up after themselves? Like this was what you're dealing with a hoarder, right? Like somebody who doesn't clean, somebody who doesn't want to throw anything away. As a roommate or a loved one or whatever the situation is,
you got to get them out. I mean,
that's all you could do.
You get out.
Or you get out. Because
sometimes you have to say, this situation is no longer tenable. Goodbye.
Right. Unless that person's willing to get help, get some sort of psychological counseling, some kind of course that they can go through. I mean, the show Hoarders is, of course, I think it's Discovery Channel or something, I don't know which one it is. But anyway, it's a good show. And they bring in, these experts. So there's like the organizational expert who comes in and kind of helps them go through all their stuff. Like, okay, well, we're going to have three piles. One's the trash pile, the other's the keep pile, and the other's the sell pile. So they sort of go through all their stuff. And this is part of the amusing portion of the show is watching people try to separate themselves
from
the pile of junk that they've just had there, like this old box of newspapers or worse, old advertisements from the mail that have come in. All kinds of just junk. An old cardboard box that they had some other stuff in that's got rat poop in it, but they don't want to get rid of the cardboard box anymore.
I just had a thing, like if there was a hoarder in Keene.
I'm sure there are.
Well, I'm just thinking the one thing that I think that somebody would have tons of is that the Monadnock Shopper.
That's the weekly kind of fish wrapper newspaper that comes out.
Yeah, there's like a newspaper that you get here that has all the coupons and stuff like that.
Right.
But I feel like those things are never ending. I'm throwing one out. Like, I feel like almost every day.
Well, that's every week.
I look through it for the coupons, but there's so many of those that I feel like if somebody were to hoard that.
Somebody's got
it add up fast. I mean, it's like getting a copy of the New York Times. That thing's huge.
Right. Yeah. The hoarder will hoard no matter what it is. It doesn't,
it's always some value to it.
There's something there that
I might use these coupons even if they're expired. They might match them.
There's no logic to a lot of it. Usually the excuse is, well, I might need this. So in
about the bottles of urine?
You never know. I mean, what if the water stops working?
It's not like you're trying to scare off deer or something.
Yeah, there's in that case, I'm pretty sure that was just the lady couldn't access the bathroom.
Could be
in that particular case. But, you know, it's a sad story because these are people you care about. And part of the really difficult part of watching the show is empathizing with the family members who don't have this problem. Maybe some of them grew up amongst this and they want to help their loved one. And
that's what I was going to mention is when you're talking about growing up there, now you're talking about a free place to live. So if you're suggesting that if you have a loved one that has this problem.
Well, right. If you're a kid, then you have to stay there. You can't leave.
Well, even if you grow up to, you know, you're 18, the question is you've lived with this for years. Are you willing to, continue to live with it in order to have a free place to live?
I can't imagine. I mean, you wouldn't be able to bring any of your friends over to your house or anything like that.
You didn't get to bring any of your friends over for the last several years.
So one thing that deeply scares me about this is that you know, with hoarding in general, is that I have also a deep respect for people who can find uses, like really good uses for mm-hmm. complete junk. So for example, like plastic water bottles, you know, like
everybody's got them.
I drink a lot of water and I have in fact at times I hoarded these to find uses for them. And because I've looked online, you can find uses for these things. So I made planters out of them. I kept them. I threw away. Once I completed my project, I started throwing them away. Yeah. But I saved them for a while, but it's just one of those things where it's like, you know, I feel it's like I'm throwing this away and it feel like it does have value. Maybe I could do stuff with it.
There's a
guy who built an island out of water bottles.
Yeah, there's a dude that built an island. I was going to mention
you know?
855-450-FREE.
If I can only collect enough.
855-450-3733. You could have your own island.
Just one more.
New Hampshire is under quarantine as walking corpses devour the flesh of the living. Max is 11 years old and surviving alone. Slow-moving and non-thinking, the dead swarm his home. Now he must apply his porcupine Freedom Scouts training to improvise his escape. Look for Survivor Max on Facebook, read reviews on Amazon, or read Chapter 1 at SurvivorMax.com.
You're faking it. You go around pretending everything's okay. You're irritable, you lose sleep, and your mind is racing with fearful thoughts. You want it to stop. You just don't know what to do. I'm Lucinda Bassett, founder of the Midwest Center for Stress and Anxiety. I can show you how to make it stop without abusing alcohol or taking medication. I did it, and so have hundreds of thousands of people just like you. Please, call now.
Call now, and we'll send you this wonderful free CD. 1-800-749-4061. 1-800-749-4061. 1-800-749-4061.
This alert just came in. This special announcement is for business owners and leaders of organizations who've been waiting for the right time to build. General Steel has made it impossible to wait any longer with rock-bottom prices that could save you thousands. That's right, General Steel, America's leader in pre-engineered structures, is offering buildings at prices you will never see again. Don't miss these prices. A 50 by 100 for $35,000. You heard right, that's 5,000 square feet for $35,000. Manufacturers, if you need a larger building, try a 100 by 100 commercial building for $129,000. You can't afford to rent with these prices. Imagine a 70 by 100 foot church building for under $69,000. With the economy improving and interest rates still at historic lows, you can't afford to wait. So call 866-91-STEEL. Lock in your price now. Call 866-91-STEEL. That's 866-917-8335.
Free Talk Live, the show where anyone can call about whatever they want. And we do mean anyone.
He bought a radiation monitor on eBay for $10.
You gotta be kidding me.
A Geiger counter?
Yeah. Okay. So I said, let's put some batteries in it and get it fired up. So we fired it up. We started walking around.
You guys
around.
Know how to spend an evening.
Yeah, right.
A couple of beers. Hang out with a Geiger counter.
We were making readings of 10 Rentgens outside the house.
What's that mean? Is that bad?
Yeah, it is.
Is that dangerous?
Yeah, it is.
Really? Now, where's the life-threatening one?
100 Rentgens. I'm really concerned now because I've seen...
But you weren't concerned before you got the radiation meter out.
Right.
Now you're definitely going to get cancer, Harry. What's the detector going to do for you, though? Really? I mean, if you're going to die, you're going to die, right?
The guy that just called in about radiation, first of all, you got a Geiger counter off the internet.
Free Talk Live, 7 nights a week from 7 to 10 Eastern, live on the Liberty Radio Network at LRN.FM.
The three most important things you can do for Free Talk Live are, one, share one episode a week on Facebook or in some other social networking site. Two, Buy the things you buy online through shop.freetalklive.com. 3. Give $5 a month to the AMP program. It's my firm belief that Free Talk Live's AMP program is the best use of your charitable dollar among liberty-oriented organizations. Support all the organizations you love. But make sure you give $5 a month to AMP at amp.freetalklive.com.
Are you a political activist who does things that the government might not like? Then this free ebook may save your life. Rats is your guide to protecting yourself against snitches, informers, informants, agents provocateur, narcs, finks, and similar vermin. Rats was written by OG libertarian Claire Wolfe. Rats is a short book, easy to read, and available free in many formats. Download Rats free at rats-nosnitch.com. That's rats-nosnitch.com.
Help get LRN.FM into more ears. Visit promote.lrn.fm for a free bumper sticker, flyers, banners, graphics, and more. Promote.lrn.fm.
Free Talk Live, 855-450-3733. We might be able to squeeze you in if you call. 855-450-free or LRN.FM.
I want to know if you've got a hoarder story. That's what I want to know.
Yeah, if you've got a hoarder story, please call in with it. Ian, you're running a fundraiser here for our to get on an as free-to-air satellite in Africa.
That's right. I'm not doing a particularly good job about it. Okay. I've never done fundraising before. I don't consider myself a particularly effective fundraiser. I know everybody thinks I'm some sort of a cult leader and that everybody follows my beck and call, but it's been pretty difficult to even raise $2,000 towards this $22,000.
Well, you have someone who has recently taken a step to help you. I listened to another show here. I'm going to mention a competitor, I guess.
Okay.
A podcast, Freakonomics.
Oh yeah, I've heard of the book.
Yes, so there's several books actually, but they do it's an economists show, and one of the they did an episode, and I'll find the link for you, but they did an episode all about fundraising, mm-hmm. and how to be most effective at fundraising. And there are some different methods, but one of the most effective people to fundraise is a young, pretty blonde.
And yeah, blonde, I don't have any of those.
Very right specifically. Very specifically, blonde people blonde women are very effective fundraisers at asking for money.
Well, I'll have to remember that next time. But it's a little too late to put together. it's not too late to, I guess, change the pitch or whatever. But we put together this fundraiser over a series of months. Like, I kept tweaking it and sort of putting it out there to the listeners, like the Free Talk Live amplifiers, asking for feedback, and got some feedback, and then I change it to make the pitch better. I think it's a good pitch. I just don't think it's been shared a lot, and so therefore, considering the small amount of views that the video has had that I made about this, which is all about why free-to-air satellite is important to get on in Africa so we can spread the ideas of freedom in some countries where, arguably they could use those ideas. And we were on in Africa. The thing is, we got taken off the air due to the fact that we were being put on gratis for like a couple of years. We had free access over Africa, and then the satellite company withdrew that, and now they would like some money for that service, which is completely understandable, and I knew that day would come at some point. So I'm looking to raise $22,000 to get us back on over Africa, and it's not just Free Talk Live, it's all of LRN.FM, and that includes dozens of some of the best liberty-oriented shows out there, and the folks over in Africa that we'd heard from really liked to hear that information. But, the liberty movement isn't that big, and we don't know all the money people, that's for sure. Yeah, we don't know hardly any of them.
For some reason, they don't listen to Free Talk Live.
Yeah, so we rely on you, dear listener, to help us with this. And if you can't afford $5 or $10, you can always share the link, which is africa.lrn.fm. But there's been some important changes that I made, I think it was yesterday or early today. And the changes include there's now lower level perks. So the previous lowest perk was $50. Now there's perks for $5, $10, and $25, which is like a recognition perk. We'll put your name on a list of contributors as a thank you for contributing. And then there's a new $100 perk, which didn't exist before, where Angel Clark from the Angel Clark Show will cut a custom voicemail greeting for you. So you want Angel Clark to say something on your voicemail, you know, the greeting thing, she'll cut that for you. And she's volunteered to do that for no pay whatsoever. I told her, hey, you know, I can give you a few bucks out of this 100. What do you want out of the 100 bucks to make this worth your while? Because it takes time.
I'm thinking of like a t-shirt. Like I paid to put a satellite in orbit over Africa and all I got was this lousy t-shirt.
Was this voicemail greeting. No, there are no t-shirts. I didn't want to deal with product. I didn't want to deal with fulfilling product orders and all of that. It's just
what, no tote bag?
No junky stuff like that. And I don't like that stuff usually when I'm looking at fundraisers. If it's
I try to avoid the t-shirts.
If you're doing a fundraiser, the way I feel about it, and I'm sure there are a variety of opinions about this, but the way I feel about it, if you're doing a fundraiser for a product, then it makes sense to give away some product with that, right? Like sure, if you're trying to do a video game or something like that. Well, that makes sense to have a copy of the game that's signed by the authors. That makes sense. Yep. But if you're doing something for trying to feed the hungry or put, you know, do some sort of charitable thing, which
give
is
away food. No,
what this is, which is what this basically is. It's a charity fundraiser. Then it doesn't make sense to have people who are running the fundraiser spend a whole bunch of money and time on fulfilling all the, you know, bags and
There's really nothing related stuff. To audio transmitted over a satellite. What are we going to do? Say you give us all $22,000 for this 3-year stint on the satellite and we'll shoot you into space too. I mean, what are you going to do?
Well, that's why I thought Angel's idea was cool. She shared that with me. She said, hey, you know, we could do this voicemail message. Yep. And the other big change was there was a $5,000, they call them perks, I guess. So you can, when you do the fundraiser over to africa.lrn.fm, you can just pick an amount of money and donate it, or you can pick one of the perks. And so what I'm talking about has changed are the perks. The $5,000 perk was to sit in studio for an episode of your favorite show from LRN.FM. And we've had like a dozen shows step forward and offer their show as an option, right? Because some people don't care about Free Talk Live. They'd rather go sit in Acapulco in Angel Clark's studio, for instance.
Well, hey, you know, I have an idea.
That's changed. Hold on. That's changed from 5,000 to 1,000. So the idea was make that a little more reachable by people and make it, you know, $1,000 instead of $5,000. So
yeah, I see no reason why, especially if it's spread out. I mean, shoot, 3 or 4 people want to come different times to sit in this studio. I don't see why that we wouldn't let them.
Yeah, absolutely. So
I have a potential perk idea, and it would require cooperation from Akko, but maybe doing some sort of a secret or potential perk show for people who have donated that involves Akko and that involves, you know, maybe some sort of report about what's going on or what, you know, like what... just sort of like news about what's going on.
I hope that we get more of that from Akko. I mean, I don't know if that's going
to be... Akko's one of our listeners in Africa. Yeah. He's probably interactive.
He calls in from Cameroon, Africa, and he drives or he has to get on a bus and go 40 kilometers just to even get to a place where there's internet access so he can call us on Skype, where he actually ends up sounding really good. I think better on average than some people on Skype. But, you know, the guy's really dedicated, and he had one of the times I talked to him off the air, he was talking about starting up a blog and maybe with the idea of eventually getting to some sort of an audio format. So that could be something that could come in the future. I can tell you one thing, Johnson, you know, if this fundraiser is successful or even if it isn't, I'll probably do it again you know, at some point just to help pay for the access. So anyway, africa.lrn.fm. Johnson, you wanted to tell us about Hoarders, the television show, which, by the way, I had said I thought it was on Discovery, but I wasn't really sure. Sci-Phase says that it was on A&E originally.
Yes.
It was canceled there, and then Lifetime purchased it, and it has now been renewed for a 7th season. So 7 whole seasons of crazy.
I've been watching it on either Netflix or Amazon. I'm not sure which. I have both. I saw an episode that just, it was amazing to me because this woman was collecting things in a way, it was hoarding, to be clear, but it was sort of like she covered every surface of her house with objects that she was, you know, calling treasures. And
treasures.
Well, they were. That's the thing that was strange.
So she was hoarding antiques or something.
She was
like
hoarding antiques. She had run a thrift store business or something like that, and like somehow stopped. Or she was just basically using her own personal home as a warehouse. And you know, I watched this after this is recent, after having been working with the thrift store and a thrift store owner here, and worrying like, I hope this doesn't happen to my friend. You know, like I hope he doesn't warehouse everything, you know, in his own living space or whatnot, and start doing this. But at the same time, as I was watching this, just looking at the items and being able to have, you know, I have an ability, I do eBay listings and whatnot, and I have an ability to sort of spot appraise certain mm-hmm. items. And so I'm looking at this going, she has, like, that's a $100 item. That's a $200 item. That's a $400 item. Like, it was like, she has real value.
Sure.
I mean, it's like most.
And it's just going to sit there until she dies.
For the most part. I mean, well, I guess no, because the hoarders crew, they come in and they clean it out, and then they start to help.
Okay, if hoarders hadn't come, it would have sat there until she died.
Oh, yeah, for sure. But what's also, I mean, it's just, it's so weird because it was a very different episode of Hoarders, because most of the times when they come in, they're just sending in crews to take out bags of junk.
Yep.
And in this case, it was all stuff worth money. I mean, it was just...
So what do they do with it?
It's just like... I mean, it would be like almost if somebody literally was hoarding stacks of money, and then you come in and it's just like, ah, there's just money everywhere. I have to dig through all this cash. Like, it's just... It was a very bizarre episode of Hoarders.
You wish
opinion, that
it was that liquid.
Yeah, right?
You know, with the money, you can pick it up and go spend it. With the antiques, you've got to...
Sell them.
You got to sell it. You have to add value to these things. You have to clean them up. You have to package them properly.
They were all clean. That was the thing. Like, you look at it, and they were it was like having just art objects on display. They were all clean.
All over top of everything.
They were just everywhere, but they were all in really, really good condition.
Mm-hmm. Was it on like the floors too? I mean, because you know,
it
when
was
you
like
watch
everywhere.
Hoarders, there's the paths, right?
Yeah.
Like the hoarder goes to the point where they only have like small, skinny paths that they walk on. Was she that bad?
I think it looked a little better than some of those, but mm-hmm. it was still pretty bad.
Wow.
I mean, yeah.
You got to be bad to be on Hoarders.
Yeah.
I pity most of those people. It's
get
a sad
them some
situation.
Help. If you're close to anybody like that, do whatever you can to convince them to get some kind of help, because
what
it's just going to
get
worse.
Get?
It's psychological help. There's
there are
programs. There's something they can do. They have to be willing to do it.
Check us out in the meantime, freetalklive.com, on Facebook at facebook.freetalklive.com.
Free talk. I've been told no in many different ways.
I give you an order and you're going to obey it.
Well, George, you can go this way.
You can't do that and you have to leave here.
You cannot bring Simon to the rally.
Walk with me.
Well, I'm comfortable here, actually.
Whoa, excuse me. Hey, who do you think you are?
Excuse me.
There is no video and audio allowed in this office.
No, I have work today. This is...
You ain't going to make
wait,
a lot of comments.
Now. Wait a minute.
Hey! Oh my God! Unbelievable!
Why are you running from me?
Because you scared me!
Property.
What am I being detained for?
You're being served.
What is this?
You're being served.
What is this?
Bureaucrats have a funny way of telling people no.
That's the sound of the men working on the chain.
Derek J's Victimless Crime Spree. Watch it for free and order the Director's Cut DVD at victimlesscrimespree.com.
LRN.FM needs your help getting our satellite signal back on in Africa. Our satellite provider had us on at no charge from 2012 through February of this year when they pulled the channel off the air. Now we're trying to raise $22,000 to continue reaching people with the message of liberty in places where it's needed most. Please visit our Indiegogo fundraiser at africa.lrn.fm. Give what you can and share the link with your friends. africa.lrn.fm. You can listen to Free Talk Live on the radio, podcast, satellite, webcam, and our live streams. But did you know you can listen to Free Talk Live from any phone, anywhere? Add this number to your phone, 213-493-0308. It's a long-distance call, so make sure you're familiar with your phone's calling plan. The listen lines are airing the latest episode of Free Talk Live 24 hours a day, including our live shows. Call 213-493-0308. That's 213-493-0308.
The latest episode of Flaming Freedom is next, after the news, here on the Liberty Radio Network, LRN.FM.
From Keene in the Shire, the Liberty Media capital of the world, this is Daryl W. Perry, host of FPP Radio News for Thursday, April 9th, 2015. Silver is trading at $16.33 per ounce. Gold is valued at $1,200 per ounce. And according to BitcoinAverage.com, the average price of Bitcoin is $244. Antiwar.com reports, despite years of haranguing from the U.S. and threats to sanction Pakistan, the Iran-Pakistan natural gas pipeline will finally be built by Chinese company CNPC, according to reports. Initially floated as an Iran-Pakistan-India pipeline, the project has been pushed as a way for Pakistan to solve decades of crippling energy shortages that have led to intermittent blackouts in major cities. India withdrew from the project in 2009, saying the prices negotiated were no longer attractive. Pakistan still wanted and needed the gas, but the U.S. State Department has repeatedly threatened to impose crippling economic sanctions on them for daring to do business with Iran. The insertion of a Chinese company into the situation changes it dramatically and seems to be the result of the latest framework deal with Iran and a planned easing of sanctions. As a permanent U.N. Security Council member, China is in a much better position to thumb their nose at idle U.S. threats over the pipeline, and given recent diplomatic progress, it will be difficult for the U.S. to even try to retaliate over the matter.
For over 35 years, Roberts & Roberts has been a trusted source for buying and selling your investment-grade precious metals. They also take Bitcoin for precious metal purchases and permanently removed the minimum purchase order for all orders paid in the digital currency. Call Roberts & Roberts today for knowledgeable advice on investing and a forward-thinking approach to new technologies. 850-478-5270 or online at rrbi.co.
UPI reports a Texas federal judge refused to lift a temporary block on a White House immigration plan that would defer deportation for up to 5 million people in the country illegally. U.S. District Judge Andrew Hanen rejected a request by the federal government that he stay his February 16th decision, which granted a preliminary injunction blocking President Obama's executive action. He said the government has not shown any credible reason why the order needed to be set into action immediately. Texas and 25 other states, largely Republican, sued to stop Obama's action, saying it was a constitutional overreach of power and would force them to spend more on law enforcement, healthcare, and education. Hanen wrote in the order, "There is no pressing, emergent need for this program. If there had been such a need, the Department of Homeland Security could have implemented the program at any time in the last 5 or even 10 years. In November, Obama signed the order that also granted benefits to some parents of legal residents and citizens. The move has become a flashpoint across the nation. The U.S. Department of Justice also appealed the matter to the 5th U.S. Circuit Court of Appeals. Oral arguments are set to begin April 17th. On Tuesday, Hanen also said the administration misled him when it revealed last month the federal government had issued expanded worker permits to some 100,000 workers in the country illegally before the court blocked the program from beginning. He told the government to supply more information on the issue by April 21st.
When her plush and comfy life suddenly and unexpectedly fell apart, Brooke and her dog Cloud set out to defy the odds. If this is a man's world, as they say, living on the streets is no place for a young woman. One day she awoke in the redwood forest and realized she had become a hobo and would ultimately come to know exactly what it means to survive. How to Be a Hobo by Brooke Willett is available from Amazon.com and all major bookstores.
Reuters reports Boston Marathon bomber Zokhar Tsarnaev's conviction on Wednesday came as a relief to residents of the city of Boston, though many expressed mixed feelings over whether the 21-year-old should be put to death for his crimes. Tsarnaev was found guilty in federal court of killing 3 people and injuring 264 others by detonating twin bombs at the finish line of the world-famous race in 2013. The jury will now decide whether Tsarnaev should be executed. After the verdict was read, bombing survivor Karen Broussard said at a news conference that she and other survivors were grateful for the guilty verdict, but she said the survivors also had differing views on whether Tsarnaev deserves the death penalty. Massachusetts scrapped the death penalty in 1984, but capital punishment is still available in cases that are under federal jurisdiction. This has been FPP Radio News, online at fppradio.com.
Following reports earlier today that Indiana University freshman Lawrence Plotnick's roommate Brian Tabor has found an excuse to go home every weekend since August, Plotnick spoke to Onion reporters about his roommate's frequent trips to his nearby hometown of Terre Haute, Indiana.
Every week since we got here, it seems like every time I ask him if he wants to hang out on Friday, he has some wedding or birthday party or something. In fact, I'm pretty sure he hasn't spent a single Friday or Saturday night on campus in the past 6 months.
Plotnick went on to cite a variety of far-ranging excuses used by his roommate to justify his constant visits home, including various family functions, a visiting friend from China, as well as his occasional desire to, quote, just hang out at home for a couple of days.
I mean, I suppose I vaguely understood when he had to go back in November because his best friend's grandfather died, but last weekend, he had to go back for his aunt and uncle's wedding anniversary. He said he couldn't miss it.
This is the Onion News Network.
Good evening, folks, and welcome to another live episode of Flaming Freedom. This is your host, Dale.
And Lauren.
And Jason.
Osborne's here, too.
Jason Osborne is here.
Howdy, guys.
Hey.
Thanks for having me.
Good to have you back. I think he's been on, Osborne, we were thinking you were on two episodes so far.
I could have sworn it was two.
I remember one for sure.
Yes, it was two.
It was two. Mm-hmm. Oh, okay. Lauren remembers.
I don't remember.
I think they were both
about.
With me, too.
They both were. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. So
that's why I couldn't decide if it was one or two. Was it just
anyway.
Cool. So we're gonna have to talk about pizza tonight, even though everyone is sick of that topic. But we're gonna talk about not so much the news story or the law, which I don't really care about. More so how people are reacting to it.
I'm really, really hungry.
I thought
we were
gonna talk
about that.
Big
need it
sausage
right now.
Pizza.
that
not
too.
That one. No.
That too.
Damn it.
And we're gonna talk about grooming standards. Like male versus female grooming standards and why that is and whether or not we should care.
Gender.
And how we should deal with that and stuff.
Bring it on.
A lot of shaving and grooming stuff will be discussed at
some
point.
Yeah, shaving, grooming, and pizza together, it's weird. Mm. It's not a good combo.
And I don't know how much we're going to talk about this. Maybe we'll think of something to say about it. But we should at least mention that the International Transgender Day of Visibility happened recently. So that's kind of a thing where you're supposed to, where we try to raise awareness about how many people have died either from violence or suicide or things like that because of transgender issues, and also try to keep, you know, be positive toward the future and hopefully have that not happen so much, and things like that. So that did happen this past week. I can't remember the exact day. I think it was late March, but it was sometime in this last week.
I feel really bad for not knowing.
I do too, because I did know, but I can't remember now.
Yeah.
I made a note of it. I made a mental note and I put it in our show prep.
Well, I remember seeing tons and tons of transgender related articles and just discussions and all sorts of stuff online. And I didn't know why. I was like, wow, this is awesome. The world is like totally cool right now.
Right.
And then now afterwards, I hear that it was like a planned event or something.
Oh.
Which is great. I mean, yeah.
Well, yeah. I mean, it's planned by activists.
It's wonderful, but I feel bad that I didn't know.
Yeah. And then there was a cool,
and we've got one more topic.
Well, there's actually a thread where we had some discussion on the pizza place and I'm going to touch on that too. But,
all right.
Someone said they missed Neil because he would say anti-mind, anti-life and anti-human happiness on earth.
Specifically referring to religious organizations. Is that
He used to say it about a lot of things, but that too.
Okay.
Yeah.
Is that like a Randian phrase or quote? A quote of Ayn Rand?
It is a Randian thing, apparently. It's an objectivist thing.
Okay. Have we found out if he's actually like trolling us all or if he's really into that?
It is very hard to tell with Neil.
Yeah.
I think everything about him is a troll.
I'm still trying to figure out if he's trolling by pretending to believe in the 9/11 conspiracy stuff.
Yeah, I'm not sure.
And
really
some other conspiracy things. But he doesn't believe in all of them. So I think if he were full on trolling, he would just be all full on board with all the Alex Jones conspiracy stuff, chemtrails.
He said he liked Alex Jones on the last time we brought it up.
Yeah, he likes Alex Jones. He listens to Alex Jones and all. But I know he's got some conspiracy stuff around fluoride.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. I'm not sure. But I think he might for reals believe in the 9/11 conspiracy stuff.
Or okay.
He just,
well, yeah. I mean, there's various levels of that. There's plenty of archives in the flamingfreedom.com archives, so we can go back and try to decipher Neil's
we
real
all
feelings.
Know he was part of the International Baccalaureate Program, right? So my feeling is that he is just a UN plant.
Oh, right. Very positive. He might need to call in and dispute you on that if he wants. We'll see. I don't know if that's going to happen. I made a joke. Right. I made a comment that he never listens to the show. And then
he was actually
listening when I said that. So that was kind of funny.
Yep.
So, okay. So
do we want to start the NSA with... inform him when we say his name?
Right. Mm-hmm. That's what it is.
Yeah.
That's what it is. So he can do damage control for his profile.
Correct.
What do you call it when the identity that you present to your?
It's called a legend. Is that it? Is that
the identity that you create? His Neil
a legend
identity
for
the show and for
I know that
the freedom
from TV.
Movement.
Not,
from TV.
Yeah. Not okay. Because I am an agent.
Not. No. Of course not. Mm. No.
The key to that is actually just reproducing a new identity every few years. That's what I do.
So what do we want to tackle first? The fun stuff or the heavy stuff? Do we want to talk about the gay pizza, the anti-gay pizza?
We'll make the heavy stuff fun and the fun stuff heavy.
Right. Right. So
it's all the same.
So here's the thing about the pizza place.
Yes.
Right. The pizza place. I've heard so much hype, and I guess is this where hype comes from? Is hyperbole?
It's the same
hype,
root.
Hyperbole.
Yes.
Yeah, I guess so. There's a lot of hype on both sides, right? There are people who are on the liberal side, and I think we can see this because we're looking at it from kind of the middle or outside of it as libertarians. But there are people on the liberal side talking about the sky is falling, and this law was specifically so people could discriminate against gay people and stuff like that. And then you had people on the other side who are milking it for the Christian victimization story,
mm-hmm.
right? That whole line about Christians are victims and they don't have any rights, and they're under attack, right? Christianity's under attack. Christmas is under attack.
Right.
All that stuff. And that is all a load of crap, too. So there's all that. And both sides are really kind of hyping it up more than what it really is. The law itself is, to me, fairly trivial. Like, it's not something to get all worked up about. But it's interesting. What's more interesting to me is how people react to it. And it says a lot about them.
Right.
And how they react to it.
And here on Fleming Freedom, I mean, we've been talking about this kind of a thing in terms of discrimination against gay people. There's the cake. The cake example is the most famous one.
Right.
So we've already had a chance to get over all
that
emotional
ugly
stuff.
Cake,
so hopefully.
The ugly cake they made for the lesbians or something.
Yes. Yes.
They asked for a cake for their wedding. And then there was two different stories. One was they made a cake, but they made it really ugly. They messed up on purpose.
There's
so
many
it'd be
cakes.
A really crappy cake. And then the other one was they just wouldn't make a cake because it was for a gay wedding.
Correct.
Right. So.
I think actually in this example, there was no discrimination
purely
that
theoretical.
Occurred. This mm-hmm. was a reporter that called and said, "Would you do this?" And they said, "No, we wouldn't do
well,
that."
Well, not only that, but it was a total it was a troll, right? Because they went to a pizza place in a town that had two restaurants total,
and there was Christians propaganda all over the restaurant.
Who were known, to have crosses and shit all over the walls, right? And then they go in there, "Hey, would you cater a gay wedding with your pizza?" First of all,
did they ask that though? I didn't see that get asked.
Yeah, who has pizza?
They ever been asked to cater any wedding with pizza?
I think I'm going to end up disputing.
And
some
when
of
have
this.
They ever met a gay person in that town? Probably
right.
never. Never on
okay.
both counts. So you're completely blindsiding someone with a question like that.
I disagree with you. Actually, yeah, okay. I think I've heard people saying this. I think that I think they're trying to get a story. There's no doubt they're trying to get a story, and they're trying to. They want. I mean, if you try, you're trying to get the opinions of people maybe from both sides. You want to hit someone who says, "Oh, I don't approve of this law. I wouldn't discriminate anyway," or whatever, and then they try to go somewhere where they expect to get an opinion of someone who supports the law. So where do you go? You go to a restaurant that has Christian propaganda all over the restaurant, right? And I don't think that's trolling. I think that's what a reporter is going to get the opinion of someone. They want to hear that someone who has that side, right? You want to hear And they're asking them, how would this law affect you? Like, how will it affect your business? I never heard them ask, would you cater? I never heard that get asked. I heard her say it, but we don't actually hear the question that was asked. The question could have been, how will this affect how you do business? And then she has to reach at that point. She's like, well, I'm not going to just not serve someone for being gay. They said that.
Mm-hmm.
And the reporter even specified that in the story. She said they're not going to refuse service to gay people necessarily. But if someone came in asking, for to cater a gay wedding, and everyone's been making jokes about that. No one's going to order pizza for their wedding, right? They're not going to have pizza.
If I ever get married again, I'm going to have pizza.
Okay, just because of that.
Yeah, everybody loves pizza,
right? But So that was kind of the joke, but I never heard her ask that. I mean, it could just as likely be that she asked her, how will this affect your business? And she's being theoretical, like, well, maybe in this particular situation, we would say no because we wouldn't want to support the gay wedding. And then they talked to the manager, and he said some really ignorant stuff as well. And, yeah, people blew up about it. I don't think they were trolling. I think that's what a reporter does. They go and they try to get an opinion of someone who supports the law. And that is a business that looks real Christian and they should support it. We'll talk some more about it when we come back. This is Flaming Freedom. Stay tuned.
If you want to move to the free state and you're looking for some real estate.
Oof. I think we've all had enough of that jingle, don't you? If you're going to invest in property in New Hampshire, it just makes sense to support a liberty-friendly realtor. Call Mark Warden of Team Porcupine Real Estate for investment property or rentals in the Free State, or visit his website. Come on, you know it.
PorcupineRealEstate.com.
The Shire Free Church offers a sanctuary to those seeking an escape from state churches.
The Shire Free Church is an interfaith, diverse group of people that may not share identical theological beliefs. As a member in or minister of the Shire Free Church, you are a sovereign individual and may be the faith of your choice.
We don't claim to have all of the answers.
We are open to all peaceful people.
We want to learn from each other.
What unifies the Shire Free Church and its diverse members is peace,
love, and liberty. There are many paths to God, one for every individual.
The Shire Free Church does not define a specific path beyond those parameters that must be your foundation.
Peace as your way.
Love as your guide.
And liberty as your light.
Learn more at church.shiresociety.com.
That's church.shiresociety.com.
The three most important things you can do for LRN.FM are: 1. Let your friends know you're listening to LRN.FM on your social networking profile. 2. Buy the things you buy online through shop.lrn.fm. 3. Give $5 a month to the AMP program at amp.lrn.fm. You likely buy all kinds of things online. Amazon is the largest online retailer. You can get what you need at the same great prices, and LRN gets a cut. Please do your online shopping at shop.lrn.fm.
Why did you move to the Shire?
I moved here to the Shire because there's other people around who take liberty just as seriously as I do.
I moved to the Shire because I saw videos of people challenging authority and thought that I could get support myself. It called to me, like, do this right